7 jam ever. She's been driven back multiple times. That is no fun when you're jamming. It's hard enough getting past them girls once, much less twice or more. All right, Ho-J Simpson for the Sugars.
And on the line for the Daisies, we've got number 8, She 88, She Who Cannot Be Named. She Who, of course, making a guest appearance on the Daisies tonight. She was supposed to be sitting next to me here in Postal Service's seat. But I will say that you don't smell of elbow and wrist pads, so that's good.
Well, thank you very much, Missy. I know I'm a poor substitute for She Who, but it is a pleasure being here.
Oh, no, I'll take a substitute anytime when they're as cute as you. She Who getting knocked to the outfield. The pack going kind of helter-skelter forces her to re-enter in the back and buys time for Ho-J Simpson.
And Ho-J is your lead jammer for the Sugars. It was rough on both of those jammers well into turn 3. But Ho-J was victorious. She is the lead jammer, and she is in on your scoring pass.
Wildy Coyote trying to set up a brace against Ho-J Simpson, but Ho-J is free, and she has picked up that jammer lap point, 5-point grand slam, and it is now a 1-point game.
That is no small feat either for Ho-J Simpson, because She Who is a pretty well-known jammer. She's got some skills.
A few skills, but Ho-J Simpson also has quite a bit of veteran presence on the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. 2 more points for Ho-J Simpson, 7 points, and now we have a 1-point game. Sugar Kill Gang up 44, Daisies 43. If you are just tuning in, because I'm not sure, you are watching the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls home opening season opener here at the gorgeous Fillmore Auditorium on ColoradoSports.tv. We have the Doomsdaisies taking on the Sugar Kill Gang, and right now your jammer for the Doomsdaisies is Lady McMassacre.
We've got Fiona Grapple for the Sugars. And the pack seems to have woken up a little bit in these past few jams. They've been getting a lot tighter and a lot fiercer. We've seen both jammers having difficulty getting out before turn 3. But it looks like Fiona Grapple did it. She's going to be your lead jammer.
Lady McMassacre picking up a track cut at probably the wrong time.
This is like a back and forth power jam game.
Fiona Grapple looking for it up against Uber Alice and number 101, Pandy Piper at the top of the pack, but she picks up 5 points for the Sugar Hill Gang.
I do love watching a jammer that just blocks their own way through the pack. That's beautiful. She's giving hits just as good as she's getting them.
Well, Fiona Grapple, also a veteran, a blocker for Rocky Mountain. She is actually no stranger to Assault and Peppa and Uber Alice and their defensive moves, because she trains defensively.
I remember I was at championships when Rocky Mountain beat Ole. That was a beautiful game.
5 more points for Grapple. As Lady McMassacre out of the pack, but she has her back in the game, but she has her jammer star in her hand right now. You will see her. She's wearing a black hockey helmet with a clear face cover. And Daisies lose Uber Alice to the penalty box.
Fiona Grapple did some very smart things there a few minutes ago. She kind of got knocked a little bit off balance. She realized she may have cut the track. She crawled off the track, got back on, and took her time coming back in legally.
3 grand slams so far on this jam for Fiona. They get 4. That's 20 points so far. Tapping her hips, falling off the jam, heading down past the 14-minute mark.
And you guys are just now tuning in here on Colorado Sports TV. Welcome to the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls season opener. My name is Ms. Communication.
And I'm Postal Cervix.
We are betwixt the game between the Doomsdaisies and the Sugar Kill Gang right now. Sugar Kill Gang up 64, Doomsdaisies 43. We'll do a little bit of a recap for you after we watch Surrey Brawl jam for the Daisies.
It's been a very close game, lots of back and forth, lots of power jams, lots of physicality.
Sharon Taco's wearing the star for the ladies in black and pink. Sweet Mary Payne shoving her all the way to the back of the pack.
Tacos did a delightful little duck and weave betwixt two bodies, and she is out. She is your lead jammer.
Right now, the Sugar's dominating that lead jammer status. The last three jams, the Sugar's have been in control, and of course, the points prove it. 64-43 right now, with Surrey Brawl out and ready to score points.
Sugar's have also had more power jams in their favor thus far in this game, which never hurts when you're trying to rack up points.
No points for the Daisies. We've got 3 points for Sharon Tacos. Now score is 67-43, Sugar Kill Gang on top. Just to do a quick recap from my little unofficial scribblings, Daisies kind of pulling ahead in the first few jams, but then about 6 jams ago, Fiona Grapple taking the star, Wild and Coyote going into the penalty box, and Fiona puts up 15 points. We have Lady McMassacre come up after that, and Sharon Tacos puts up another 10. We've got another power jam from Fiona Grapple with 20 points, and that's where you see the score now. Hojay Simpson wearing the star for the Sugar Hill Gang.
Looks like we have a star pass for the Sugar Hill Gang.
And she who cannot be named is lead jammer for the Doomsdaisies.
Sugar's got tired of being stuck behind a wall, so they passed it. Got Coco skating. She is going to be jamming for the remainder of this jam, which is very short, as it turns out.
Coco Rola Diva putting on the star, not picking up any points. But 4 points for Shihu and the Daisies. Now the score is 67-47 with 11 minutes left in the first half. This is the second star pass that we've seen in this first half of the game, and both times the star pass not yielding any points, although you could make the argument, of course, that it's a defensive move.
It does usually force a quicker call off, so it's kind of a triage. Kay Paso just getting escorted from one line to another. She's trying to stay in the middle. She's using her toe stops, but Daisies are doing a fantastic job of forcing her out and back.
We've got number 8747, Frack. Good attack. Yes, 8757, Frack attack. Out in front, lead jammer for the Doomsdaisies.
Looks like the pack is speeding up a little bit.
K-Pasa out and ready to score, so the Daisies speeding it up so that they can keep their jammer in the pack for as long as possible.
I always forget how much easier it is to knock people around when the pack's actually skating a little bit. Fiona Grapple's back, taking the star for the Sugars.
And Surrey Brawl putting the star on again for the Daisies. Score right now 67-51, under 10 minutes left in this first half. So is it like a stability thing? If you're going faster, you can't get knocked over as easily?
Well, when you're going faster, you have more like physics, centrifugal force, something like that. I mean, you can definitely hit somebody hard if you're standing still, depending on where you hit them and how stable they are. But if you're going quicker, you just have the forces of the earth working in your favor, especially if you're hitting to the outside at high speed. So,
ladies and gentlemen, that break for science was brought to you by Postal Service.
You're welcome.
Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. Surrey Brawl is lead jammer.
Fiona Grapple is right behind her, hoping she can pick up a few points before the Daisies figure it out, and she was unsuccessful, sadly.
Great jammer awareness by Surrey Brawl. 2 points for the Daisies. Score now 53-67. Sugar Kill Gang up on top. Once again, you are tuning in to the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls season opener at the fabulous Fillmore Auditorium here on ColoradoSports.tv.
We've got a little hipster derby for you guys. We're starting at the pivot line because reasons, and we've got Tacos jamming for the Sugars.
And Colorado Sports commentator number 147, Havoc, with the star for the Daisies.
And Tacos is your lead jammer.
Havoc out as well.
Got very, very lithe looking jammers in this jam. Very similar, looks like skating types. That was a beautiful little duck and score there by Tacos.
4 points for Sharon Tacos. She has jammed 5 times in this half, and 4 of those times she has garnered the lead jammer status.
And she is having a fantastic game.
She's going to start to gain the lot for giving a 30-second power game.
The Sugar Hill Gang have informed me that they love to win all the after parties. They said this is actually going to be a very transitional rebuilding year for them. They have 5 new skaters. Apparently one actually came back from the dead. Well, not one of the new skaters, but one of their skaters came back from the dead, literally. So that might be putting a little fire in their skates tonight.
Sharon Taco sent to the penalty box for skating out of bounds right at the end of the jam, apparently illegally calling off the jam, I believe. We've got Bones Control out there. Lead jammer for the Daisies. She breezes through the pack. 5 points.
Sugars are bracing in front. They've got a nice tripod, hoping to catch a jammer in it.
Daisy's sending number 949, Wildy Coyote, back in from the penalty box. Daisy's at full strength. Sharon Tacos gets through.
She came out of nowhere. That's when you're nice and compact like that, you can hide.
Bones Patrol contending with Ellie. Extinction level event at the top of the pack. She calls off the jam. Total of 9 points for Bones Patrol and the Dooms Daisies in that last jam. And we have a gap of 9 points on the scoreboard, 71-62, with 6 minutes remaining in the first half.
Those power jams, man. These are two, I think, very closely matched teams, but this power jams, it's going to make or break this game. It's like Hojay's back on the line for the Sugars. She looks prancy and excited.
And we have Lady McMassacre on the line for the Dooms Daisies.
One jammer takes the in, one jammer takes the out. Both teams doing a great job of recycling them to the outside and back.
Gray hit by Kay Pasa and number 6 pack. Absolute, keeping McMassacre in her place.
Neither one of these teams is letting anybody go, but it does look like Hojay is going to be lead jammer.
Hojay out, ready to score. Dooms Daisies sending Payne to Piper to the penalty box as Lady McMassacre is out and ready to score points.
Daisies are picking up the speed a little bit. They're trying to keep Hojay from scoring points as easily, giving their jammer a chance to lap the pack and hopefully come up with a few points. And she does call it off in time. No points were scored. Somebody's going to the box, though.
Yes, we have an illegal procedure contact after the whistle. We're going to see who gets sorted out into the penalty box.
Refs are real sensitive about that stuff. It's weird.
Yeah, you know, it's almost like an illegal hit after the whistle is blown and you're not supposed to be hitting people would be illegal.
Well, you know, I mean, it could just be a little, it's like a shoulder high five, maybe. I don't know.
All right, you know? A shoulder high five.
Yeah.
Well, we'll see what the Court of Opinion has to say about that. We've got a team timeout being called by the Dooms Daisies.
Fallen Angel looks like she's going to be jamming, I believe, for the first time tonight for the Sugars. The Sugars want to give a shout-out to Montclair Elementary School. Apparently, they're hanging out here somewhere.
Oh, hooray, Montclair Elementary School. You know, if you're not partying with the Sugars, you should party with elementary school teachers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like,
I
think they are second place at every after party.
Oh, yeah.
The elementary school teachers.
They deserve it.
Closely followed, of course, by nurses.
Yes. Agreed.
Yes. Agreed. So right now we've got two jammers lined up at the line, Sweet Mary Payne and Fallen Angel. I believe we actually had an official review happen. We've got Shred Mosby coaching the bench for the Sugars. You know what? Actually, we could probably go. Well, oh, nope, our refs are back. I was going to say we could go through the rosters for you since we turned in and you tuned in a little bit late for those, but it looks like we'll be getting back to the action here shortly. There's lots of explaining to do. The Dooms Daisies tonight have brought number 101, Payne to Piper, number 12, Bones Patrol, number 1223, Purdy Vicious, number 147, Havoc, 27, Alex Terminate You. At 3 pounds is Surrey Brawl, 34 is Lady McMassacre, 3773 is Betty Booya. Number 45 is Tijuana Pistola, 86 is Assault and Peppa, 87-57 is Frack Attack, 88 She Who Cannot Be Named, making a guest appearance. Niner is Uber Alice, 949 Wildy Coyote, M80 is Sweet Mary Payne, and P1NU is Teaches Peaches. And we are back, Sweet Mary Payne wearing the star for the Daisies.
It's like Fallen Angel was actually trying to do a little defense there at the start, trying to help out her blockers. That's always good when your team's short a few blockers. Just as important that the other team doesn't score as it is that you do.
Sweets picks up the lead jammer status, but about 30 feet behind her is Fallen Angel.
Sweet Mary Payne taking that 1 point and ending it. Because a 1 point differential is better than a no point differential.
So Postal Service, you join us from the fabulous Bay Area Derby Girls.
I do. If Ms. Moxie's listening in right now, I hope I do you proud.
And are you primarily a blocker or a jammer when you play, or do you like to do both Cs?
Bay Area, I mostly blocked. I jammed a little bit when I was skating with Silicon Valley. And I have nothing but admiration for jammers. I always tried to do as much offense as I could when I blocked because I remembered how much it sucked.
While the Coyote wearing the star for the Doomsdaisies, but Sharon Tacos becomes lead jammer for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Tacos has also had a really good game.
She really has, Postal. She's dominated that lead jammer status, and now just finding that line on the inside as if the daisies weren't even paying attention. 5 points.
She has her own special express lane.
It is. Look, it's like a drive-thru window.
It is.
Right there.
I bet there's a toll, though. Get it? Yeah? Few little smacks? Yeah, she's earning it.
And Cher Tacos on her third scoring pass as we have a handoff to Uber Alice, number niner. She's out and ready to score for the Daisies.
I think Tacos is finally paying the toll for that lane. She got a not-so-fun-looking hit. She was facing the track and took a hit that knocked her backwards.
Three more points for Sharon Tacos as Violet Assaults yells, call it, call it, call it. Score now 87-63 with 3 minutes and 15 seconds left on the clock.
Looks like Ho-J, number 32, is on the line for the Sugars.
She is up against Suri Baral and four of the Daisies.
Pack starting again at the pivot line.
Suri Baral has actually been a Daisy ever since she joined the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls a few years back. It's been more than a few years, but we like to make her look young.
She must have so many different colors of tights.
O.J. Simpson getting called to the penalty box on the track cut, and Suri Baral weighs in as lead jammer.
This is a great opportunity for Doomsdaisies to close that point differential a little bit.
Sugar Kill Gang losing number 215, Sylvia's Wrath, to the box. They're not running at full strength, and Suri Baral says, I'm strong enough for that. Five points for the Daisies.
It was interesting. The Sugars weren't doing the traditional bridging where one person kind of skates and then stops. They were both kind of drifting up to the front a little bit.
Suri Baral knocking off of Kay Pasa. She's up at the top of the pack and free. We've got another 5 point grand slam for the Daisies. O.J. Simpson getting ready to re-enter.
Daisies are already walled up and ready for, but it looks like the Daisies are doing a little bit of offense back there for their girl. And she's out.
O.J. out and ready to score. Suri having a rough time in the pack against the Sugar Kill Gang blockers.
Some really good pack awareness in that last jam.
4 points for the ladies in blue and yellow. That was a 14-point jam for Suri Baral. We have a 10-point game now. Daisies at 77, which was a very fine year. And the Sugar Kill Gang at 87. A minute and 20 seconds remaining in this first half.
Got Fallen Angel on the line again for the Sugars.
And Shihoo on the line for the Daisies.
A little playful jammer slapping there. That was cute.
They want you to believe it's playful.
It's like, I'm so going to lap you so many times, but I love you.
Sweet Mary Payne anchoring as pivot with Assault and Peppa and teaches a Peaches of making the compliment of Daisy Blockers and Shihu out.
Oh, Fallen Angel was trying so hard to stay clean. She kind of got knocked off balance, tried to get off the track, but unfortunately she was still on her feet. And she was past the penalty line box, so she had to do a full lap, and now she's having a seat for 30 seconds.
This is the second penalty for the Pink and Black Jammer. She who had picks up 5 points.
We are at 82-87. We might see a lead change here in this jam, Missy.
You are going to hear some what sounds like booing, but if you are not a Rocky Mountain fan and familiar, it's because the crowd chants "Shoo!"
Yes. Well, boos are just cheers from ghosts, so it's okay.
Five more points for She Cannot Be Named. She's back in the pack. And, oh, the daisies sort of shifted all right.
That was a very impressive hit. One of the Sugars just got knocked halfway across the track there.
A little 1-2 punch from Coco and Jersey World sets She Who out to the infield. Fallen Angel still fighting here as Badass sent to the penalty box.
Fallen Angel being very, 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 very careful to come in legally this time, eyeing that ref the entire time. Looks like we're going to have a star pass.
We have zero, count them, zero on the penalty clock. On the period clock. We've got five more points for She Who as she goes in for another scoring pass.
And we got Coco. She is now jamming for the Sugars. That's somebody fresh and energetic.
She Who threw with another 4 points. That was a 19-point jam.
Wow.
The Doomsdaisies actually picking up 33 points in the last two jams. They have taken the lead now at our 15-minute halftime. We've got the Doomsdaisies up 96. Sugarkill Gang 87. Holy wow. This is why I love home team competition. You know, a lot of people like to say, ew, well, we just have our A team and our travel team and our whatever team, and we don't have home teams. No way.
Definitely. The teams that you skate against the most often are the teams that you know the best, and that's when you start seeing really creative, exploitative use of strategy and individual weaknesses and strengths. Like you can watch the skaters change their strategy the minute a star has passed, the minute somebody else takes the line, or the minute two skaters are in the pack together. I always loved home team games the most.
Definitely. We have the Sugarkill Gang leaving the track here for our halftime, and we are going to go ahead and leave you at this break. 96-87 Doomsdaisies on top over the Sugarkill Gang. We've got another game coming up after this. The United States Pummeling Service against the Denver Roller Dolls, Bad Apples.
I am very excited to see that game.
We are mixing it up this year and having a little home team throwdown between the Denver Roller Dolls and the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. Anyway, my name is Ms. Communication.
And my name is Postal Cervix.
And we will be back in roughly about 13 minutes. Auditorium. We've got the Doomsdaisies taking on the Sugar Kill Gang right now. 96 to 87, Doomsdaisies up on top. We had 23 jams in the first half. Of those jams, 12 times the Doomsdaisies held lead jammer status and 10 times for the Sugar Kill Gang. That obviously shows in the difference of scores. High score jam for the Daisies was 25 points for Sweet Mary Payne. That is the period high score. Fiona Grapple picked up 20 points, and that is the Sugar Kill Gang's high score. I am now joined by Postal Service.
That was some beautiful math there, Missy.
Thank you. I like to be good at math because girls are good at everything.
Yes. Especially now that I have a calculator on my phone. I rock at math now.
I should make you a shirt that says that.
Fiona Grapple is suited up with the star and ready to go for the Sugars.
She will be skating against Sweet Mary Payne.
Thirty minutes set on the second period clock.
This is actually the second home team matchup. Rocky Mountain actually had a closed game already this year. And you are also going to see a battle of the teams this year. Rocky Mountain and Denver Roller Dolls going head to head. That first game, home teams head-to-head, is going to be next with the United States Pummeling Service taking on Denver Roller Dolls Bad Apples.
Fiona Grapple recycled all the way to the back. That was a very explosive bit of defense there by the Daisies.
Sweet Mary Payne, your lead jammer. She's got three blockers to defend with, and one of them is Gagan.
Looks like we are going to have, eventually, a star pass here for the Sugars.
Well, it may just be a stash right now, especially if the Daisies have anything to say with it. That's number 12, Bones Patrol, who's got Fiona's number right now, as Sweets picks up another 5 points for the Doomsdaisies.
Nope, that was in fact a star pass.
Star pass to Ellie. So Sweets is going to call off. But Sweets picks up 4 points, calls off the jam, 14 total. In that jam.
Kipasa is ready to go for the Sugars.
And she is up against Payne Piper, jamming for her first time. We have some score issues that need to be resolved right now. It's kind of stuck at 97-87 for some reason. The points from the last jam have not been updated.
Well, that's okay, because I still need to read the roster for the Sugars. We've got number 100% Bat Ass. We got 128 Coco Roller Diva. We got number 13, Jersey Whirl, 16, Southern Discomfort, 2012, Extinction Level Event, or L, 215, Sylvia's Wrath, 222, Fallen Angel, 31, Fiona Grapple, 32, Hoje Simpson, 33, Sharon Tacos, 422, Gagan, Six Pack Absolute, who's your captain, number 76, French Kiss of Death, 840, K-Pasa, DOA, Undertaker's Daughter, who is in fact an Undertaker's Daughter, coaches, assistant captain Violet A. Saltz and Mosby.
Fun fact about Violet A. Saltz, she's actually wearing the black version of my brown shoes that I'm wearing today.
We're ship sisters. So cute.
Colorado Sports TV is happy to yet again carry Colorado Roller Derby here on our site to you for free. Now, of course, you can imagine it is not free to put on this production. You will notice that there is a donate button on your screen. If you would please click that, I would suggest.
Yeah, if you could see Missy and I right now, we look legit. Like, we look straight up professional.
Very much so, and I would suggest a donation of $10. That's $5 a game for your watching experience tonight here on Colorado Sports TV.
Uh-oh. I wonder if anybody noticed that. Yep, there we go.
Ew, is that a mouth guard?
That's
Ew, it's
mouth
a mouth guard.
Guard.
Is she going to put it in her mouth?
She's going to put it in her mouth.
She's
going to do it.
Oh, that is
She looks sad
absolute.
About it, but she's going to do
it.
Oh,
it's going to go in her mouth. Wait, I think she's even facing the camera.
Yeah.
Oh.
She did it.
Oh, for gross.
You know, this is how we immunize ourselves to derby germs.
Well, you know, they did that study.
Mm-hmm.
that leagues have their own germs.
Yeah.
Like
I
each
remember
league has their own strain my, of bacteria.
My derby wife would just grab my extra mouth guard out of my bag. I'm like, those aren't even your teeth, girl. She didn't care. It brought
sure,
us closer.
I am pretty sure that the little bacteria from the Denver Roller Dolls are glittery.
Yes.
And I am pretty sure that the little bacteria for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls probably have seen Fight Club way too
yeah,
many times.
Yeah.
Yes. Sugar Kill Gang trying to rile the crowd to chant SKG.
Sugar Kill Gang was one of the two original teams for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls, so they've been around a while. They've earned some cred.
Correct. The Sugar Kill Gang and the Red Riding Hoods, the original home teams here at Rocky Mountain.
Some very colorful leggings out on the track.
We are still working to resuscitate that scoreboard, ladies and gentlemen. We've got the crowd here. We have people up in the VIP section up top. We have people in the VIP section here next to the track. Pretty full crowd here tonight, including a couple of servicemen or women. Haircuts, they're hard.
Yes.
Enjoying the military discount that the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls get.
I'm currently enjoying the Fillmore's alcohol offerings. Very classy wine that they unscrewed and peeled a film off of, and it's already in glass form.
Wow. You know, coming from Northern California, that must be high class for you.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a type of wine I've never seen before.
Oh, it's like a mason jar. They unscrewed the lid from your cup.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. Of course, folks, we have Doc Tucson in the house spinning his tunes like a DJ. And what do you think of the Fillmore?
The Fillmore, if I could steal all these chandeliers and take them home to my new house that I was able to afford because I don't live in the Bay Area anymore, I would.
Yes, they are some fantastic, fantastic chandeliers. Just so you know, the Fillmore Auditorium used to be the Mammoth Event Center, and before that it was the Mammoth Skate Center.
I was about to say, this kind of has the look of like an exceptionally classy skating rink. The floor, for those of you that can't see it as well, is a beautiful hardwood.
Yes, the Mammoth Skate Center opened up in 1890, I believe.
Back when they were skating on rocks.
Yes, back when they were skating on rocks. It opened as a skate center and then turned into the Mammoth Sports Events Center, where old school tilted track roller derby was played in this building as well. So we had old school derby. I'm assuming that since it was open way, 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 way long ago, that we also had even older school, you know, co-ed running into each other on the track, roller derby being played. Perhaps even, I just found out that my friend Maxine, who is my friend's mom, was a roller derby queen.
Huh.
Yes, but she wasn't known for hitting people because she didn't wish to tear her nylons.
That's
because
important.
Those were in short supply in the 40s. So she says about her roller derby experience, I basically skated in a circle faster than everybody else because I didn't want to tear my nylons. We've got Kay Pasa on the line up against number 101, Payne De Piper. This is Payne De Piper's first jam, jamming for the Daisies.
Yeah, we'll see if both teams are able to stay on the track a little bit more in the second half.
Pack looking extremely spread out over the apex.
Kay Pasa is wearing her star more like a beanie right now. Oh, she's got it.
Kay Pasa out and is the lead. Payne De Piper putting on the paint. Undertaker's daughter headed for a 30-second sit.
It's also much easier for jammers to get past when people are skating a little bit faster because they don't have to slow down and they can use all that jukey goodness.
We are still waiting for that scoreboard to update, and of course I didn't catch the house people who are keeping track better than I am. 3 points though for Kay Pasa in that last jam, and the Daisies putting Wildy Coyote on the line.
And we got tacos on the line for the Sugars.
Ooh. Sharon Tacos with an amazing first half. Hopefully she'll be able to keep it going here in the second.
Daisies are doing a good job of keeping her in the back right now and recycling her. Tacos has been very consistent. Oh, that was gorgeous. She did a little, like, slide, jump to her feet, and she is back out. Now the Jammers are neck and neck.
Sharon Tacos, though, holding that lead jammer status, but Wildy Coyote hanging out like an anvil off the cliff.
It is very, very, very hard to grip that line going fast when you're going around the inside corner, and that's where Tacos kind of...
Wildy Coyote chasing her into the pack. 1 point for Sharon Tacos, two netted for the Daisies.
Fiona Grapples ready to go for the Sugars.
And we have Sweet Mary Payne on the line for the Daisies.
Without the scoreboard, this game kind of looks like one of those elementary school games where everybody wins and they don't keep score anymore.
Perhaps, but I'm pretty sure people are keeping track because there's a lot on the line when you're talking about a championship.
Yes. A little bit.
Gagan called for blocking out of bounds, buys just enough room for Sweet Mary Payne to break free. Lead jammer.
Daisy's getting a few more lead jams this half of the game.
Big hit by Fiona Grapple on Frack Attack as she exits the pack and is ready to score.
Sweet is going to call it out 4 points.
Jersey Whirl almost did an after the whistle hit, but she held herself back and was a lady. Well done.
Sometimes you are able to sneak up on Frack Attack like a bunch of robot people. She Who Cannot Be Named with a star for the Daisies. Hoje Simpson, number 32, on the line for the Sugars.
Daisies have a slight pack advantage right now.
She Who looking for it on the inside against number 222, Fallen Angel, and Hoje gets out of the pack.
Hoje just went right up the middle. She's like, I'm not going to try and edge anybody. I'm just going to block my way through.
Yeah, there's nothing slow about that, Bronco. She Who Cannot Be Named is about 10 feet behind Hoje. Coco not catching up to the pack coming out of the penalty box, so Hoje calls it off. We have a 0-0 jam. Once again, thank you for tuning in. You are watching ColoradoSports.tv's coverage of the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls 2015 home season opener at the Fillmore Auditorium here in wonderful Denver, Colorado.
Sunny Denver, Colorado today.
Very sunny.
I'm
but
mostly
we won't
fall.
Tell you how warm because everybody will want to move here. We've got an official timeout being called. We've got a penalty being assessed for out of play blocking to Coco.
From
I apologize. That was a delay of game penalty being called on the captain, Coco, from the Sugar Kill Gang. She will sit in the penalty box.
For the delay of game. So that looks like a full minute in the box.
For 30 seconds here, starting the jam, we've got Sweets on the line for the Daisies. Oh, wait.
Frack Attack.
Sorry, that's Frack Attack on the line for the Daisies.
Tacos just skates up the middle like she owns it. She is out. She is your lead jammer, but she is being chased.
The Daisies right now running away with the pack, 4-2 pack advantage belonging to the Daisies. And the Daisies are like, all right, let's have a little couple skate.
Let's hold hands and skate fast. This is like old school, like skate as fast as you can for as long as you can.
We have two scoreless jams in a row and we've got a scoreboard.
Oh, it's so beautiful.
And we are going to go ahead and sync up the time and the score on the scoreboard. Right now the time is still showing 28-23, which is when that got reset. Sharon Tacos, of course, lead jammer in that last jam. Sharon having an amazing game here tonight, being highly effective as a jammer, being perhaps because she can find that
drive-through lane.
Yeah, she doesn't hesitate. She, when she approaches the pack and she has the speed and she sees a hole, she goes for it. Sometimes you see jammers coming up and they'll actually snowplow a little bit before they hit the pack, and then they wait a few seconds before they go, and that's all the time a good blocker needs, just to set up to knock you out.
Well, and we certainly have the daisies kind of ignoring the infield whenever Sharon Taco seems to be jamming. Big hits at the top of the pack. Sweets comes out lead jammer. Daisy's losing a salt and pepper to the penalty box.
Yona Grapple is out.
Fallen Angel headed to the penalty box as well as Teaches of Peaches. We've got 4 points for Sweets. She calls off the jam.
Notice that the Sugars jammers are mostly trying to approach the pack in the middle whenever they can, which is really smart because that gives you several feet on each side to maneuver a little bit if you start getting swept to the outside. But if you take the outside or you take the inside and you get caught, you're pretty much screwed because they're going to be smart and drive you back. So sticking to the middle and giving yourself some room to work is a very good strategy when you're jamming.
120-91, Doomsdaisy's on top. OJ Simpson with the star for the ladies in black and pink, but Wildy Coyote becomes lead jammer for the Doomsdaisy's. OJ looking for it against Shu, cannot be named, and what other blocker to beat? Oh, and Shu waterfalling knocks OJ all the way out into the suicide seats.
Corner, outside corner is a dangerous place to be. Oh, and it looks like Wiley Coyote is going to the box. This is going to be a power jam for the Sugars.
Wiley Coyote has picked up her second track cut as a jammer. She's also served time in the box for being a blocker and getting penalties. Shihu out to the penalty box as well. OJ Simpson out and ready to score for SKG.
For those of you that can't see very well, there's actually not a whole lot of floor outside of the outside track. So when you get hit out at high speed, it's a little scary.
OJ picking up 5 points. We're going to go the full 2 minutes of this marathon jam, of which 50 seconds are left. Fun fact, big hit to the outfield by Surrey Brawl. Forces OJ to recycle back a little bit of a disarray there on whether or not she should go. Another 4 points for Wildy Coyote. That's her first scoring pass.
OJ Simpson doing a good job of really dropping her shoulder when she's getting pinned by a blocker. That puts a little more force against their hip and she can fight back a little better.
Wildy Coyote counting them up. 5 points, grand slam for the Doomsdaisies.
Missy, do you know if this is our correct score? Have they gotten everything?
Indeed, we have a correct score, correct period clock, and 6 seconds left on that jam clock. 5 more points for Wildy Coyote.
We're standing right now at 134 for the Daisies, 101 for the Sugars.
An additional 5 points being awarded to Hoje. When she got stuck in the pack, she had already picked up her jammer lap point for Wildy Coyote, but then Wildy Coyote putting on the steam plows through. That jam was 14-10.
I'm sure the Sugars are hoping that the Daisies will commit another jammer penalty. I'm sure they would love a power jam right about now.
Number 12 Bones Patrol on the line for the Daisies, and she is out, the jammer.
Tacos is right behind her.
Bones Patrol looking to enter the pack. Shihu dragging behind, a big collision with Absolute. Absolute going to her feet. The jam was called off, but that hit was so big that half the people taking a knee. Crunchy saying, no, get up. That was not an injury call, ladies and gentlemen, not an injury call.
Looks like Bones Patrol just had the wind knocked out of her a little bit. She landed on her back.
No points for either team in that jam. 134-101 right now. Daisy's on top.
Fallen Angel back on the line for the Sugars.
She's up against Payne DePiper.
We've got a lovely, neatly segregated track here.
Yes, very segregated. It's like Alabama in the 60s out there.
Yep. The Sugars are in the back. Daisies are in the front. Each team has a little wing woman for some offense.
Daisy's actually netting 1 point in that last jam, 135-101, with Payne to Piper up at the top of the pack. They have to let her go. Lead jammer belongs to the Doomsdaisies.
Looks like we're going to have a star pass for the Daisies. Or no, maybe that was a fake out. Yep, that was a fake out. It almost worked, too.
Fallen Angel stashing that star, but slipping on the straightaway coming out of the pack. Four more points for Payne to Piper, 139-101, with 19 minutes and 16 seconds on the clock.
Yeah, I'm seeing some girls in hybrid wheels, so this floor might be a little more slippery than it looks.
But the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls have made the Fillmore their home for the last 2 years, so they know the floor.
You know, even at Bay Area, they skate on the same floor every game, but it's still an issue sometimes.
Fiona Grapple with the star for the Sugars, picks up lead jammer, but Suri Brawl hot on her heels.
Pack started to speed up, and then they're like, meh.
Fiona shaking her head, no. No points for either team, but she did call it off in time. You will need to stay tuned. Our next game will actually feature Ms. Grapple on the microphone.
Ooh.
Entertaining you out in the world land.
She speaks and skates?
She speaks and skates, ladies and gentlemen, just like our own postal service.
Yes. Hoji Simpson looking very energetic again for the Sugars.
Frack attack on the line for the Daisies.
Very tight pack. It's just a whirling mass of pink, black, yellow, and turquoise.
For a little while there, actually, both jammers were trying to draft off the other to get through the opposing line. OJ and Meyer at the top of the apex. By, I believe that's a Salt and Pepper. Frack attack breaks free. Lead jammer, Daisies.
Sugar's not having an easy time getting their jammer through. The Daisies are doing a fantastic defense.
Gagan with the star in hand breaks free from the pack, is now ready to score points, and is an active jammer, forcing Frack attack to call it off. 3 points for the Daisies, 142-101 with 17 minutes left in the first half.
It's very obvious there's a lot of camaraderie between these two teams, too. I'm seeing a lot of playful little slaps and smiles and high fives, and you can tell they're having a lot of fun, which is, you know, what else can you ask for, you know, besides winning by a lot?
See, I like to think of those playful little slaps like antlered animals fighting one another, where we think they're playful little slaps.
Or evaluating her muscle tone.
Could be.
You been doing squats, girl?
Could be. Sharon Taco's on the line for Sugar Kill Gang. She's forced to recycle back behind number 86, Assault and Peppa. Welding Coyote with the Star Daisy on her helmet for the Daisies.
That was some very impressive backwards bridging there by the Daisies. One knocked her out, but they made sure to bridge that way they wouldn't get an out-of-play call, and the backmost skater...
Sharon Tacos picks up 5 points and calls off the jam.
So I do notice the Daisies have not been going to the box like they were in the first half. They haven't lost as many jammers to the box. And they are really starting to creep up in points. So they definitely had a little conversation, talked about some things, made some adjustments, and it's really showing in the second half.
Score now 142-106. Daisies on top with 15 minutes left in the half. She who cannot be named.
Got Fiona Grapple for the Sugars. Like Fiona Apple was trying to draft off Sheher there for a minute, and she is out, and she is going to be your lead jammer. This is the first time in a while, I think, that the Sugars have had lead jammer.
grapple lead jam or Shihu about 15 feet behind her, but those daisies up at the top of the pack playing some default strategy.
Oh, Grapple's so happy she got her point. She was having a little hissy fit there. She was so mad she couldn't get past that wall.
And Coco doing a little bit of an impression of her.
That's the beautiful thing about a four wall. If you can get past one, you've gotten past them all.
Team timeout being called by the Sugar Kill Gang, 142-107. That league record on the line, 14:54 frozen on the clock. So I'm seeing the Sugar Kill Gang stalling out, only 6 points for them in the last six jams, 7 points netted total for the Sugars, but the Sugars have certainly put more points up on the board this half. Sugars with 46 points this half. I'm sorry, the Daisies with 46 points this half. And we've got 14, 15, 16 netted for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Yeah. Again, first half, Daisies had a lot of jammer penalty problems, and the Sugars had a whole lot of power jams to play with, and their jammers really took advantage of that.
Daisies fielding Frack Attack, number 8757.
We got Ho J. Simpson on the line for the Sugars.
It's funny because you can tell who bought new uniforms this year and who didn't.
Yeah.
should be using that Tide for colors or
yes.
whatever.
Yes. It's like, I'm having a hard time reading her numbers. She must have been skating for a while.
These are actually not new players in the darker uniforms. Most of them were Daisies last year.
Oh, okay. Yes. I think everyone should get Coco shorts. That should be the new uniform for the Sugars because those are beautiful.
They are pretty fancy.
Nice two-wall, three-wall up there for the Daisies. However, Hoje's out because she's Hoje.
The Sugars have held lead jammer status for the last three jams, but like I said, they've only netted 6 points in the last three jams. Hoje looking to turn that around as Coco making a brace with number 13 Jersey Whirl, hoping to keep Frack Attack in her place.
We are going to have a star pass for the Daisies.
Frack Attack handing off to Uber Alice. Uber Alice right now with the star in her hand.
It really speaks to the defensive capability of the Daisies that despite not having lead jammer the past few times, they've still really been able to minimize the amount of points the Sugars have been able to score.
And once again, we're going to see that minimalization. Uber Alice out of the pack, ready to score points. Coco headed to the penalty box. So Hoje picking up 5 points in that last jam. Very hard fought.
Well, we still have a little over 13 minutes left in this half. So if the Sugars can just keep getting 5 points at a time, keep getting lead jammer, they can still take this game. I'm sure they'd rather have a power jam, but, you know.
Fiona Grapple putting on the star in pink and black and Payne DePiper in blue and yellow.
Sugar's got a nice little tripod in back there. Communicating very well. I could see a lot of mouths moving in that pack.
Payne DePiper having some trouble with Gagan and number 840, Kay Pasa. Payne DePiper being forced to recycle, as Gagan says, to the back of the pack.
Lots of rotation chips there. Both jammers got recycled, but it does look like the Daisies are going to have lead jammer for this game. This jam.
That's right. Piper with that lead jammer status. The Fiona around the outside against the Lady McMassacre, ready to score.
It's just a writhing mass of bodies there in the pack. Everybody's hitting everybody.
But not before 3 points are scored by each jammer.
We have 3 points scored by each jammer. Fiona Grapple picking up 3 points, sneaking him out of the way. And that's where, you know, I actually kind of feel like jammer awareness, that idea that you two were split at birth and you always know where the other one is at all times, is kind of the like second most important thing to skating fast.
It really is. Well, when you think about it, jammers have the best view of the game of anybody on the track. They can see everything when they're coming up, and it's difficult while somebody's beating you senseless and you're trying to get through the pack to know where the other jammer is, but that can be the difference between a 3-0 point differential and basically a null point differential.
She who picks up lead jammer status, Sharon Tacos, still in the fray. Tacos taking her start off of her helmet, but keeping it stashed. No handoff to Absolute.
And she is out, so she's going to go ahead and put that back on.
Four for She Who calls it off.
Four for She Who cannot be named. She calls off the jam 149 to 115. Postal,
I don't think anybody is fooled by a star stash.
No, it's funny. It's kind of like, oh, is this star what's making you mad? Let me just take it off. Do you feel better now? Are you going to stop hitting? No, no, that doesn't make it. Okay, fine. I'll put it back on.
Why are you hating on me?
It reminds me of little kids that think that if they cover their eyes, you can't see them. It's like, you know. Yeah.
Good metaphor.
Right? It's all metaphors, man. Gagan is jamming right now in her jean shorts for
Gagan's
the Sugars.
First time with the star that was not handed to her. And she is up against Sweet Mary Payne. And Sweet's out in front, lead jammer for the Daisies. Daisies holding lead jammer status, lost three jams.
It's fun to change it up with some new jammers in the middle of the game. Nice little step over there by Gagan. She is out of the pack.
Sugar's losing a Southern Discomfort to the penalty box. Sweets at the top of the pack had figured, wow, that was, I wouldn't have guessed that my hips had passed four people, but 4 points to the Daisies. Gagan and the Sugar Kill Gang held scoreless for the second jam in a row, 153-115 with 9:52 left in the game.
Yep, that is the danger of the four wall. Somebody gets past one of you, you've pretty much gotten past everybody. That's one of the nice things about the tripod strategy that a lot of teams have been using the past few seasons is if you get past one, everyone else can still rotate around and you don't get all of those points at once.
Havoc on the line for the Daisies up against Hoje.
Hoje again trying to take the middle, trying to keep herself from being pushed out to either side. She's mostly able to stay in the middle right now, too. She only has one more person to get around. She's out. She is your lead jammer.
Hoje timing out, lead jammer for the Sugar Kill Gang.
Havoc back out of the pack, ready to score points as well. Fiona Grapple looking to anchor the pack as pivot for the Sugars. Pivot in the penalty box for the Daisies.
You remember when pivot used to mean something?
It does mean something still.
Besides just hold my panty. Take my hits for me. Actually, it's true. Now that the star pass has become more popular, teams have been very smart about putting double threats, blocker jammers, in as the pivots, just in case it's needed.
But Absolute on the line for the Sugar Hill Gang up against Bones Patrol.
I remember proudly putting my toe stop on that line because I was the only one that could when I had that striped helmet panty.
That's right.
Those were the days.
Line, sweetie.
My pivot line.
153-119. Daisies on top. 8:25 on that clock.
Both jammers just being taken from line to line to line. A lot of good lateral movement in the pack there, but it looks like the Sugars are going to have lead jammer for this jam. Nicely done there by Absolute.
We've got pressure being put on Absolute. She passes her going into the pack, and Absolute is forced to call off the jam.
Yeah.
I was just going to say, Lady McMassacre has not jammed this second half, and now she is putting on the star for the Daisies. Lady McMassacre actually doing the most damage to her team last half. She jammed 5 times, and 3 of those times she went to the penalty box. So we've seen her blocking a lot, but this is her first time jamming in the second half.
Sharon Tacos, on the other hand, jamming for the Sugars, has jammed a lot, and she's really good at it. She's already at the front. She's pushing past those last 2 blockers. Oh, she is taken out. And it looks like she is going to be going to the penalty box for a high block.
We have a blocking with the head penalty and a misconduct penalty.
Oh, so she's going to be in for a full minute. Like it's 2011.
Yep.
12? I don't remember when that happened. I stopped caring once I stopped jamming.
Like it's 2013.
Yes.
The 1 minute penalty went away in 2014. Yes. 5 points for the Dooms Daisies.
We only have a little over 6 minutes left in this game. I'm sure the Sugars are not pleased that they have a jammer in the box right now with this type of score.
Massacre pushing the outfield, calling it off. That will extend the power jam. 3 more points for a total of 8-0
in that last jam, 161-119. Doomsdays is on top with 6 minutes left in the game. You know, that wall on the far side of the track between turns 2 and 3, you had mentioned it earlier, Postal. I will let you know that we can sanction games here in the Fillmore. There's just barely enough room there to make that lane.
Yes. I skated similar games in the Santa Cruz Auditorium, another gorgeous venue, and it was barely legal. It was like midnight on your 18th birthday, barely legal.
So Betty Bouya, number 3773, for the first time tonight, anchoring this power jam for the Daisies.
Jersey Whirl is jamming for the Sugars. She is looking exceptionally energetic and light on her feet. She's all toe stops.
Coco headed once again to the penalty box for a 30-second sit.
Nice sticking to the floor there by Taco.
Betty picks up 4 points.
4 points for Betty Bouya. She calls off the jam. But mostly the gain for the Sugarkill Gang in that last jam is getting their jammer out of the penalty box and putting some fresh legs out on the track.
Yeah, well, we saw in the first game, jammer penalties are no fun.
Wildy Coyote putting on the star for the Daisies.
And she is up against Fiona Grapple.
We have an official review being called by the Sugarkill Gang. Look, that's my twinsie shoes.
Aww.
Out there, Violet.
Yeah, you can tell these two teams definitely know each other because the change in strategy was immediate coming into the second half. And it's interesting, too, because even whoever loses this game isn't going to stop trying any harder because a lot of times it can come down to differential. So if whoever loses this game loses by less than another team who loses to the same team, they'll still be placed higher and they may have a better shot at championship. So it's a beautiful thing about Derby. Never say die. It's like the Goonies.
Of course, these games are often made up by power points. The Sugarkill Gang giving up 2 power jams in one jam, of course. And the Daisies giving up 1 power jam. However, the net gain on points, power points given to the Sugarkill Gang while Wildy Coyote was in the penalty box, they were only able to make 5 power points.
Now we have an official time.
And then 14 points were scored by Wildy Coyote when she got out of the box, and another 5 for Hoje Simpson. So 10 to 14 in that jam. Power points basically not coming into play. However, when Sharon Tacos went into the penalty box 2 jams ago for a double penalty servation, that was a net game, a gain of 12 points for the Daisies. So Daisies definitely capitalizing on those that power point ability.
Yeah, you can have the best skaters in the country, and it doesn't do you any good if they can't stay on the track.
Sugar, don't get off the hook.
Which then would I wish to ask you, does that make them the best skaters in the country?
This is true. Yeah, this is true. Well, we saw that in at the tournaments, too, the WFTDA tournaments. You would have a team that you would think would easily beat their opponent, but if they can't stay out of the box, you had some upsets. And it's always fun to watch because you're right. I mean, staying on the track is just as important as skating ability, if not more so in this game, because again, you can't do a whole lot with your butt in a seat.
Wildy Coyote with the star for the Daisy. She finds it on the outside lead jammer.
Fiona Grapple still trying to go up the middle.
Fiona Grapple hit to the outfield by Assault and Peppa. A little bit of friendly fire on Wildy Coyote for Peppa.
Looks like the Daisies are losing a skater to the penalty box.
Bones Patrol out for a 30-second sit. Coyote through for 5 points.
Fiona Grapple still stuck behind a very nice-looking Daisies 2-wall up there in front.
That's a Sweet Mary Payne and Teaches of Peaches at the top of the pack. 4 more points for Wildy Coyote as Fiona breaks free. She calls off the jam. Score now 174-119. 4 minutes left in the game. Once again, we want to thank you for tuning in here on ColoradoSports.tv for our coverage of the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls home opener. You'll notice that on that page there is a donate button. We are able to provide this to you for free at home. And we suggest that you please help us cover our expenses by clicking that donate button and giving us a few dollars.
We've got Extinction Level Event L taking the star for the first time tonight for the Sugars.
She is skating. It's Piper, Paige Piper. This is Ellie's first start with the star, but she did receive the star from Fiona Grapple the first jam, and now you see why we give Ellie the star, because she will blast through the pack and go beast mode on you.
She is right behind. And it looks like she was not able to score any points, but she was able to haul it around the track quick enough, so the Daisies only scored one.
It makes me so happy to see Ellie out on the track. As many of you know, and some of you don't, in December, she actually collapsed and had to be revived.
She came back to life.
Yes.
And she is living for roller derby.
And what she wants all of her friends in the derby world to know, Postal, is that everybody should learn how to give CPR and how to use an AED.
Yep, I got my certification in my purse right now.
I am getting my certification at the end of April.
Well, if anything happens to you, Missy, I got you.
Awesome. That's Sharon Tacos fighting at the back of the pack against Frack Attack and Uber Alice.
She just got hit forward a little, but unfortunately it was forward and out of bounds, so she wasn't really able to capitalize on it. A nice little two-ball there by the Sugars, holding that jammer back for a few extra seconds, but unfortunately it wasn't enough for their jammer to be able to fully escape.
Lead jammer belongs to Lady McMassacre, but Tacos is hot on her heels.
Tacos was trying to come around quick enough to grab a few points before the Daisies noticed, but she was not successful.
1 point for the Dooms Daisies brings the score now to 176, 119, 141, less than 2 minutes on our period clock.
Got absolute six back on the line for the Sugars.
And that's Wiley Coyote for the Daisies.
It's like Battle of the Cool Leggings.
It is Battle of the Cool Leggings.
I don't know, man. Little Mermaid.
Will it be Little Mermaid or Capri?
Oh, well, check it out. Absolute just, you know, skips up the inside for fun.
You know, there's something that can be said for a classy Capri with flowers.
Exactly.
On it.
Yeah, it's classic.
Oh, or maybe it's a kind of trying to be tie-dye.
And she might, in fact, own the inside line because she just took it again. Maybe she bought it when we weren't looking. I don't know. Real estate's reasonable here. Like she takes a little tumble there on the corner.
Coyote out of the pack.
Ellie being sent to the penalty box for a 30-second sit. Absolute looking to find it on the inside.
Abs went to the infield.
And she was able to call it off quickly enough so the Daisies did not score any points on that jam.
7 points for the Sugar Kill Gang as they call a time off. 176, 126. We've got 36 seconds left in the game. And you may have heard the music kind of crescendo.
Yes.
That's because Doc Tucson is a bit of a dramatic kind of guy.
I don't understand what you're talking about.
House starting to fill up here at the Fillmore. Definitely more seats and seats. I guess that Denver rush hour traffic finally was defeated. And we've got fans in seats having a tasty beverages here at the Fillmore.
Looks like there's a little bit of jazz hands going on at the line.
We do have some magic. Alex Terminacci being joined by Hoje Simpson, doing a little modified robot.
Nice.
And waiting in the wings, ladies and gentlemen, we have the Denver Roller Dolls, Bad Apples, ready to take the track and warm up to take on the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls United States Pummeling Service, or USPS.
I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, it's going to be great. It's going to be the battle of navy blue and black.
It's like Denver on Denver action.
Oh, yes. And anchoring this last jam for their teams, we've got Sweet Mary Kane.
Nice tripod there by the Daisies.
Hoje trying to make it past
Havoc, but Lee Jammer belongs to Sweet Mary Payne and the Daisies. O.J. Simpson out and ready to score. There is still one timeout left for the Sugars, so Sweets is going to have to run a little time off the clock if she wants this to be the last jam of the game.
It's so hard for a jammer to do.
4 points on the board for Ho-J and the Sugar Kill King. Period clock is at zero. Sweets picks up 4 points, calls off the jam, and that, folks, is the game. Our final score right now, 180 to 130. Dooms Daisies taking the 1-0 record for the season. Postal, what were you seeing in that game? What changed the tide? Because really, the Daisies and the Sugar Kale game were neck and neck headed into the half.
Yeah. Well, and again, I talked to the Sugars in the beginning, and they had said that this year, well, they had taken, I'm like watching all of these teams skate out right now. In the beginning, we basically saw the Sugars really take advantage. Not only their jammers were taking the middle, their jammers were very effective at taking the middle. They were taking a lot of risks. They were jumping into holes. And the biggest thing is they really took advantage, I think, of all of those power jams. They played really smart. They were able to rack up lots of points. Their jammers, again, took a lot of risks, went for the middle. And then by the second half, I think the Daisies kind of dialed it in, figured out what was going on, and really tightened up their game. I saw a lot more tripods. I saw more of the Daisy jammers taking more risks. They were mostly going for the inside and the outside, but when they were doing it, it was really effective because a lot of the Sugars were like keeping their tripods in the middle and they weren't able to react quickly enough. So,
well, here we go, folks. 180 to 130. Dooms Daisies put a little bit of a flower in their lapel.
Yes. Well, and the Sugar Kill Gang said that this year was going to be a big transition year. They had 5 new skaters. They really wanted to rebuild. I asked them a little bit of last season. They're like, we don't want to talk about last season. This is a whole new season. So I honestly think that, you know, they should be really proud of themselves for the points they put up and the fight that they put up. And I think this is going to be a great season for them.
Okay, then. Well, stay tuned, folks, here on Colorado Sports TV. We have the USPS of RMRG taking on the BA of DRD.
That is so many acronyms, I can't even take it. I worked in education.
Once again, my name is Miscommunication.
And I'm Postal Cervix.
Remember to hit that donate button. Colorado Sports TV's coverage of the home team opener here at the Fillmore for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. I'm Ms. Communication.
I'm Fiona Gravel.
And we are watching the second game tonight between the United States Pummeling Service of
Rocky Mountain Roller Girls against the Bad Apples of Denver Roller Derby.
Correct, and we're just going to run down the rosters really quickly tonight. The Bad Apples have brought number 107, Speed Avantes, 116, Rampage, number 1258, Smackaroni, 320 is Virginia Creeper, 352 is Mike, 382 is Charlotte Bupowski, number 4
is CMY,
KO, number 44 is Jersey Justice, number 53, or C53D, is D-Day Doll. Number 75, making her return to the Denver Roller Dolls, is Biju Black and Blue. Number 80 is Angela Depp. Number 82 is Quigley. Not skating tonight, but we do want to let you know that number 66, Mazel Tov, is bench coaching right now with a broken ankle. And number 9, Helitrix Lestrange, their coach is Papalot.
And skating for the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls, USPS, United States Pummeling Service, we've got 138, Devastator, 1968, Pixie, your battles. Number 247, Nadine Friday, 3006, Nikki Bricks. 3CHO Flipper, she's the captain. Number 4, Whiskey Ginger. 4041, Leslie Borden. 555, Barbie Boop. 8011, Love Hurts. 813, Blue Shelly. She's another second captain, excuse me. Number 88, Shihu. H1N1, Quarantina. R2D2, Phantom Menace. T800, Titan, I Am. And the coaches, Honey Bunches of Oaks and Emma.
And as the United States Pummeling Service takes to the track for their introduction, let's go over a little bit of a recap here. Last year, the USPS took their second championship in a row.
Yes.
They are the newest home team at the Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. Mm-hmm. But of course, as those names that you read off, we know there are quite a few folks who have been around the track a few times.
Yeah, we've got some OGs on that team. Barbie and I have skated for almost 10 years. She and I both started at the same time. Strong team. They are the team to beat, at least within our league. And I love this interleague play that we're doing now. This is fantastic.
We are actually going to take these games and run them into an interleague championship.
Awesome. See who comes out on top.
And speaking of coming out on top, the Bad Apples last year in Denver Roller Dolls competition finished third. But that was hotly contested. It was on a technicality, actually.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
The Bad Apples were tied with the Green Berets as far as records go, so then it goes down to points.
Oh, okay.
And, of course, Papalot thinks that the points weren't counted properly. And, of course, Jimmy Tight Pants, the former coach of the Green Berets, thought that they were.
Oh, of course.
And the Green Berets ended up second place last year.
Well, and this is going to be Angela Death's last bout skating with Denver Roller Derby. She's moving to Portland. I'm not sure if she's going to be playing with Portland, with Rose this season. You know, they've got a couple of Denver's players over there for the last year, and we're sad to see Angela go. Again, she and I think she and I started right about the same time. 10 years here. She's leaving a big legacy. We're sorry to see her go.
Now, Fiona, you've done a little swapping between leagues yourself.
I have.
Were you a Bad Apple?
I was a Bad Apple, and I was a Shotgun Betty back in the day. I've been with Rocky Mountain since 2010. I actually got to go as an alternate when Rocky won Nationals. So, and we've been chasing that rainbow ever since.
Chasing the rainbow ever since, ladies and gentlemen, Fiona Grapple and Angela Death. And that is the first whistle. That means we are going to start out this game.
All right, looks like we've got R2D2, Phantom Menace, jamming for USPS, and number 80, Angela Death, kicking it off for the Bad Apples.
You will notice that the USPS are in navy blue uniforms with a red stripe, and the Bad Apples are playing in black.
That's a little hard to
see. Yeah, it's navy blue versus black, ladies and gentlemen. Hopefully that Colorado Sports TV coverage is nice and clear on your computer screen.
All right, we got Menace finding her way to the front. She is lead jammer. Angela Death is still stuck in the pack. She jukes around on the inside, and she is hot on her heels. Menace is about a half a lap ahead.
Here comes Angela Death.
Titan I Am doing a little bit of a chase after Angela Death.
Menace punches through and calls it. She does get all 4 of her points.
For 4 points.
Angela Death getting awfully close to that pack for comfort. We talked a lot in the last game about jammer awareness.
Yeah.
and that idea that you were separated from birth and always should know where the other jammer is.
It's super stressful too, because you have to weigh the risk of, you know, trying to grab one or two more points before you call it off. Maybe she's going to sneak in behind you. Maybe there's going to be a penalty. You go to the box. We got a pivot line start, so we're taking it back to 2009.
And that's number 44, Jersey Justice, against Devastator. And Jersey out in front, Lee Jammer.
Devastator is one of our newer skaters as well. Doing a great job as a jammer. Devastator punches right out. She's right behind. Jersey gets hit to the outside, calls it off. She's got 3 points on that.
Jersey, of course, a member also of Mile High Club. She skates under her government name, Busick.
Yep. She and I skated with Team Colorado in Florida this year. We actually, Team Colorado won the entire championship. It was great. It was a mix of skaters from Rocky Mountain Roller Girls and Denver Roller Derby.
There were a few Boulder folks in there as well.
Not that went to Arizona on the bank track in January. That was a lot of fun.
Charlotte Popowski putting on the star for the ladies in black and red.
And Nadine Friday, number 247 for USPS. Nadine stuck in the back behind a strong wall with bad apples. Quickly hits her to the outside, but she does go down.
Bupowski with the lead jammer point. She's staring down the USPS blockade that will happen even with rain or snow or sun.
Nadine is hot on her heels. Looks like Barbie Boop is headed to the box for her trip of the... Oh, maybe not. Yes. A little bit of confusion on where she needs to sit.
3 points for Bupowski.
Good luck saying that after another beer.
Right. Bad Apples now up 6. USPS 4 with 27 minutes left in the first half. And Angela Death puts on the star for the Bad Apples.
We've got number 4041, Leslie Borden, jamming for the first time with USPS. Angela gets swept to the inside by Shihu and, who is that, Pixie? She's stuck behind a strong wall. Leslie punching up the middle.
Leslie looking for the inside. She gets the lead jammer point, but Angela Death out in front.
And now it's a matter of recognizing that you're lead, even though you're not out of the pack yet.
Shihu being sent to the penalty box for a 30-second sit.
Yeah, Leslie doesn't realize that she's lead jammer. This is really confusing when this happens. Oh, now there she goes. Now she figured it out.
Leslie Borden gets it called off.
And we've got Bijou Black and Blue that was just in that last jam. She is the she recently left Rocky Mountain Roller Girls. She's now skating with Denver Roller Derby. I believe this is her inaugural game this season with the Bad Apples.
This is her inaugural game back with us at the Bad Apples. Phantom Menace on the line for USPS. She is up against Jersey. Sorry, I should say Jersey Justice because we had a Jersey last game. Jersey Justice.
You did. There's a few jerseys, actually.
Yeah, 1 or 10.
Uh-huh. All right, Menace still stuck in the pack, but she is coming around the turn. She is right behind Jersey Justice. Jersey's got about a half a lap ahead of her.
USPS taking the lead at the top of the pack, trying to skate away in hopes of not being a point, but Jersey.
Whoa, hops around on the inside, stays in bounds. Great job by Jersey Justice.
Four more points for the Bad Apples brings the score now 12-4 with 25 minutes left in the first half.
We've got Devastator back on the line for USPS, and number 382 is that's Bupowski.
Bupowski.
I love that last name.
I'm trying to remember. This is awful. I am a bad announcer for Denver Roller Derby. I believe that Bupowski is a transfer, though, not a brand new kid.
I think she is. I've not heard that name with Denver before, but she looks like a seasoned skater. I don't think she's brand new. All right, so Devastator punches out. She is lead jammer, but Bupowski is right behind her. USPS lining up in the front. They're going to try and grab a couple of points for their jammer before she has to call it off. Devastator swings in, calls it off. Did she get any points?
Tater no. Calls it off,
did you see? Bijou just sort of like put her, took us out, and said, I'll accept whatever you're going to give me.
Yeah, Bijou is well known for having an extremely powerful rear end. Trying to find a tasteful way to say that.
A stopping rear end?
There's not a tasteful way to say that.
A stopping took us, ladies and gentlemen. Bijou Black and Blue. 12-4 right now. Bad Apples on top. Still plenty of game with 24 minutes left in the half.
Got Angela Death lining up. I believe this is her third trip out as jammer against Nadine Friday with USPS. Nadine trying to find a hole, going from the out to the in. Angela doing the same thing. Nadine gets forced out to the inside. She does swing around to the out. Nadine Friday is at the front of the pack. She's got to push through. That's a really solid wall with the bad apples. She does swing around. Nadine Friday is lead jammer with USPS. Angela Death gets recycled all the way back to the back. She's going to try and play a little jammer on jammer defense. Oh, that might be a low block, but nope, nobody called it.
It might be, but it wasn't.
I hate low block calls. I'm glad they didn't call that.
Great work by Quarantina and Blue Shelley doing a little 1-2 punch on Angela
really
Death.
Really nice.
Angela Death still on her initial pass with a minute 20 on that jam block.
Nadine is on her scoring pass, but she is having a hard time passing up that wall in the front. Denver Roller Derby doing a good job having that backwards facing person bracing it. Angela is out and ready to score. Nadine is still trying to pick up her last few points. However, Blue Shell is going to, or no, that was Pixie.
Friday getting a little Price is Right coaching from the crowd.
Yeah.
She calls it off with 4 points.
I like that. I'm going to steal that. That's always a bummer, too, when you're blocking for your jammer and you take your own jammer out. It's happened to me on more than one occasion, and you're, like, apologizing as you're going, I'm sorry.
Score 12-8 right now. Bad Apple's still on top, but only by 4 points. That's one scoring pass for those of you who join us a little newer to Derby.
So 7 minutes in, this is actually a pretty low scoring game so far. Leslie Borden back is a USPS jammer against Jersey Justice. Nice hit to the inside from, was that from Shihu? Who I think is going to the box for that. Jersey does swing around on the inside. She is lead jammer. Leslie's still trying to find her way through. Quigley and Bijou holding her up in the front of the pack.
This is actually Shihu's second trip to the penalty box, and we only have had 8 minutes in this game.
Ruh-roh. Jersey swings through 4 points. Leslie is out of the pack. She is coming around. Jersey's going to call it off.
You know, there was still a good 40 feet between Leslie and the pack. I may have waited a little longer and let that clock run out a bit more.
Yeah, trying to get your blocker out of the box. And again, that's one of those things too where you get a little bit more of a seasoned jammer and you start to recognize. It is really hard when you're a beginning jammer and you've got the chaos of trying to get out and now you're out and do you call it or are you lead? And then, oh my God, you have somebody in the box and your bench coach is yelling at you. And she's doing a great job though. She really is. Phantom Menace on the line against number 382,
Pawski.
Menace coming through on the inside. She has two more to beat. And she is through for lead jammer.
Phantom Menace is clear. Lead.
Pawski's still trying to fight her way through. She's stuck behind. It looks like Flip. Barbie Boop with a big hit in the front.
Man, Barbie just ricocheting off.
Oh. Barbie and Titan taking her back. Shihu trying to get her to cut, but Pawski recognizes that. She's going back up through the front. That was interesting. She, like, slid through.
Phantom Menace picking up 5 points. She's now on her second scoring pass. But Pawski still looking for her additional pass.
Oh, Menace just got called for a cut track going to the box.
Pawski now the only jammer on the track. We've got 1:07 remaining in the jam as she breaks free, ready to score. The pack's basically stopping around to turn it two. Right in a Rocky Mountain fan territory. That end of the track is quite loud on Rocky.
Yes. Barbie Boop trying to hold her up in the front, forcing her to the outside. But she does juke around. I believe that was 5 points for Bukowski.
Flipper sent to the penalty box for 30 seconds.
All right, Bad Apple's trying to play a little offense. Shihu taking her to the outside. She does get around. Oh, nice apex jump. She landed that. Oh, Shihu fighting her for the front. You got to watch that direction, though, when you're facing backwards that way.
Man, Shihu with the waterfall. Now she's just like, okay, now we're going to go back. Let's go forward. Let's go back.
Meet my friend, the inside of the track.
Menace back in for the penalty box. She was already sitting on points when she went into the box, and now she has another 5 points for the USPS.
That, if you're going to go out for a power jam, that is an ideal situation to be in. She's still ahead by five.
Apple's losing number 352, Mike, to the penalty box.
See Angela Death again, jamming for the Bad Apples against Devastator, number 138 for USPS. We've got Whiskey Ginger, Quarantina, Pixie, Your Battles, and Love Hurts taking the back line for USPS.
That last jam came out a net 9-10. Phantom Menace picking up 10 points. Bupowski picking up 9. Score now 26-18, and we've got 19 minutes left in the first half.
Devastator pushing her way through. Angela Death getting forced to the outside. Devastator takes advantage of that fall, and she is lead jammer.
Angela is still fighting at the top of the pack. The problem with falling is you have to fight them again.
It is exhausting. The worst is when you're almost out and somebody grabs you, and then you have to start over again.
And suddenly she hoops in your face.
Or Barbie. I've been the recipient of a couple of sternum hits from Barbie, and it is not very pleasant.
Another 2 points on that pass for Devastator. Four now, 6 points between these teams. 20 for USPS, 26 for the Bad Apples. 18 minutes left in this first half as Jersey Justice steps up in black.
We got Nadine Friday jamming for USPS. Nadine's going to start back a little bit. Sometimes this works. You can follow that jammer through.
You've got the Apples making the line off of the jammer line, but you know when you've got Quigley anchoring Mike,
it's a little rough.
You need a running start and then some.
Yep. And what needs to happen, see, all right, so USPS is going to transition back, hopefully get her out, but she actually breaks three on her own, takes the inside.
Jersey Justice out and about 30 feet ahead of Friday.
USPS doing a good job of holding her, only picking up 1 point on that scoring pass.
1 point for the Bad Apples. No points.
We've got 14 points in the last four jams for the Bad Apples and 12 for the USPS. The game right now, score 27-20, 17 minutes left on that clock. Obviously, defense is coming into play heavily.
It's going to where you have one scoring pass and call it, one scoring pass and call it. If they can keep the power jams down, I think it's going to be a pretty close game.
CMYKO for the Bad Apples.
Leslie Borden jamming for USPS. Both jammers still stuck in the pack. Leslie's pushing through at the front. There is a good wall of three Bad Apples holding her up. Looks like, was that she who's coming back for some offense? Barbie Boop trying to get her through on the inside, holding.
Both jammers in the pack.
Oh, Barbie takes her to the inside and goes all the way back. Pixie battle bridging for her Barbie, trying to get a little extra space.
Leslie Borden
finally becomes lead jammer. We've got, that took almost 40 seconds for a lead jammer to be declared in this jam as KO is free and ready to score points.
Man, Leslie punches through with no trouble at all. She does pick up all four of her points and calls it off.
Called off.
KO doing a little twirly off to the apex. I believe this is KO's first time playing on the wood here in the Fillmore.
The floor is actually really nice tonight. It's just a tiny bit sticky. The very first time we ever played here, the Fillmore was trying to be helpful, and they said, we buffed the floor for you. And I went, oh my God, no.
Oh, no.
Got Angela Death versus R2-D2 with USPS. Angela Death taking the outside, R2-D2 on the end.
Phantom looking for it, but Mike again being embraced by number 1258 Smackaroni, holding her back, buys time for Angela Death to become lead jammer for the Bad Apples.
Menace takes her helmet cover off. She's looking to possibly pass that star. Looking for her pivot. However, her pivot is engaged with pushing their jammer to the outside.
Sorry, I'm kind of busy with AD right now.
I'm doing something else right now. She's like, oh, wait, there you are. Hey.
Titan takes a hold of that star cover.
Star passes are hard, too, as the pivot, because you're basically doing double duty. Angela Death comes through for a grand slam. 5 points picked up for the Bad Apples. Quarantina headed to the box. That's her first trip, I believe.
And Mike headed out to the box, at least her second trip there, because I've said her name before. Angela Death finding it on the outside, skates right past Titan, who is just breaking free and putting the star on her helmet.
Quigley just got sent to the box, and I'm not sure what for.
Pack advantage right now, 3-2 for the USPS, but Angela Death not looking to give any ghost points to the Phantom. That was beautiful. Did you hear what I just did
there? That was amazing, actually. Yes. Were you waiting all night to say that? You're like, no, I just can't wait till they're out there.
It just happened magically. That's right, folks. Here on Colorado Sports TV, it just happens magically. We get more magical if you click on that donate button right on our website. Remember, we're doing this for you for free. Those paywalls go up if we don't receive donations. Score 37-24, 14 minutes left in the half. We've got a team timeout for
Bad Apples, I believe.
Yes, when everybody takes a timeout, it's sometimes, you know.
And sometimes it turns into a team timeout to an official timeout.
There we go. It's actually USPS.
Oh, just kidding.
That has taken the team timeout. We really have seen a real heavy defensive game happening here. I don't have many points adding up in my little unofficial scratches. High-scoring Jam right now is tied between Phantom Menace at 10 and Angela Death at 10.
Which is really not that high of a scoring Jam. It's been those single pass, you know, pick up 4 points, call it.
Not at all, especially when you're sitting on the 20-point Jam from the previous game.
Oh, my God.
On that Power Jam.
I mean, Power Jams are a gift when they're in your favor, but as a jammer, when you're tired and then you realize you have to skate your ass off for the next minute, ugh.
It's like, go fast, but you won't have to worry about the other lady for a while.
Right.
Devastator on the line for USPS in Navy jersey.
Jersey has a nice juke to the outside and an apex jump on the end. She is lead jammer, but Devastator punches out right behind her. She is hot on her heels, maybe 20 feet back. Got Quarantina coming through. She has to wait to touch her until she gets within 20 feet proximity of that pack. But, man, she's got her eye on her. Look at her watching. Devastator coming up, a little jammer on jammer action.
Jersey deciding, I got time, but quickly saying otherwise.
Yeah.
that quickly, she is a bossy lady, but bossy in the best way that you
it's
can
right.
say about a lady.
That's all right. Bossy on the track is a good thing.
So zero, yeah, that was 3 points found for Jersey on that pass, 3-0.
Apples are slowly chipping away. It looks like they've got a 16-point lead. Math is hard. 16-point lead?
So we're more than halfway.
Yes.
Yeah.
I have to count on
my
fingers.
Oh, my. Listen, I've got 3 kids, 2 in algebra. I can't. I'm lucky if I can add 2 and 2.
40-24 right now. Apples on top. 13 minutes left in the first half. And we've got Charlotte Bupowski on the line. She took quite a break. It's been
a few jams.
5 jams since she has jammed.
Nadine Friday trying to work her way through. She has taken to the outside. Bupowski recycled all the way to the back. Nadine Friday jumps out for lead jammer.
Charlotte in the pack.
Bupowski's still stuck in the pack, stuck behind. Looks like Whiskey Ginger. Nice hit to the outside by Nikki Bricks.
Reset. Charlotte makes it to the front of the pack.
Nikki Bricks going in pursuit, but Bupowski ready to score. Quigley headed to the penalty box.
Is that her third trip now?
I lose count with Quigley. Did I say that out loud?
Do you know I did not go to the box one time last year?
I know.
Had zero
I
penalties.
Saw.
That's a big achievement for me.
Yes. Indeed. 3 points for the ladies in blue. Score now 27-40. 12 minutes and 39 seconds remaining in the half. We've got an official review, Papalot, out there looking to officially review things. You know, actually, I'm seeing some interesting differences between the first game tonight and the game now. The first game tonight was all about jammer penalties.
It was. Power jams can make you or break you, and they broke us, unfortunately.
And the daisies came back very, very clean in the second half.
They did.
So what we're seeing out here is, I haven't relatively even in blocker penalties, no jammer penalties, one jammer penalty thus far.
For USPS, right? We've had one.
Correct. Phantom gave up a track cut, but then made a net of 4 points, so power points really didn't come
into play. Which is okay. Basically a wash.
But what we're seeing right now is I think U.S. Pummeling Service is living up to their name.
Oh, yeah.
They are pummeling.
They have got some pummelers. They've got some big hitters on this team. Barbie Boop, we've talked about her a little bit. Whiskey Ginger is an up-and-comer. She's another one. She's just a solid skater. She really deals out some good. She finishes her hits. And she likes those sternum checks, too.
Titan IM doing a really good job as being the nail in the hammer and
yes.
nail. For those of you who are new to Derby and want to know what a hammer and nail is, it's when one blocker hits you, and then right away the second blocker comes in, and Titan IM seems to be the one who's on it.
Uh-huh.
Right that moment.
Yeah.
Nail.
That's good. That's
nail.
Good. Blocker,
nail.
Good blocker awareness, too. You know, and a lot of times when you're blocking like that and, you know, you've got maybe that jammer contained, but you can't do much more than sit on her, you're really hoping one of your girls will come in and, you know, take her. Come on, help me out. Take her to the out.
Well, it seems to be when you are a blocker, and I will go out on a limb here as I don't skate, but I can ask a skater, right? So it seems as a blocker, you're kind of a waterfall forward, bring them back, and then push forward and bring them back. And if you can't work in forwards and reverse that quickly, it doesn't work out well for you. But USPS doing a really great job of kind of, you know, pulling forward, Shihu getting in the face up at the front, and pushing back into the pummeling service's rest of their line.
Well, the game has changed so much in the last few years. I mean, if you would have told some of us older skaters that we would be spending a good third of our time backwards, I wouldn't have believed it. It's really, I mean, look at this formation right now. Rocky's got two skaters facing backwards, two facing forward. We've got Angela Death jamming, R2-D2 Phantom Menace for USPS. Denver is at a deficit, right? They've got two or three. They've got three blockers? Two? I can't see.
One, two, three.
Three.
Yes. 40-27, 12:33 on the clock, and Phantom Menace finds the ultra route on the inside, a lead jammer.
Angela Death still stuck in the back. Phantom Menace coming around for her scoring pass. Coming up through the middle with relative ease. Angela Death is out of the pack, though. She's hot on her heels. Menace picked up 5 points on that. She did get a grand slam. Is she going to make it for a couple more points before she has to call it off? Now, this is where USPS needs to grab somebody. Try and pick up a couple of points for their jammer. Oh, Menace says she grabs at least two. 3 points on that jam.
Total of 8-0. USPS holding the Bad Apples scoreless in the last two jams. Score now 35-40. We're within 5 points. That, folks, is one pass with a jammer lap point. That's a 5-point grand slam for those of you that maybe don't watch the derbies as often. We get a lot of people that watch bowling on Colorado Sports TV and then say, oh, roller derby.
Right on.
So I like to try and explain a little bit about the game. Quigley with the pivot stripe. Jersey Justice with the jammer star.
Jersey gets out very quickly for lead jammer. Devastator still stuck in the front of the pack. She is taken to the inside, recycled to the back, taken to the outside. Quigley,
Jersey finding it on the outside, breaks free, and 5 points for the Bad Apples.
Man, when Quigley gets on you, when she gets her butt on you and sweeps, oh, Quigley just forced a cut. Devastator's going to be headed to the box. She's a fantastic blocker. She really is. She's got great awareness and good positional blocking.
That's actually, I am learning how to skate right now, Fiona, and the thing that scares me most about Derby is scrimmaging against Mile High Club. So that is my goal, is to get scrimmage ready.
You know what? That is the best way to learn how to play roller derby. It's hard, but that's how you get good.
Jersey Justice putting up another five. That's 15 thus far in this jam. The power play proving valuable to the Bad Apples.
She's now got the highest scoring jam of this game so far at 20 points. She is coming around. She's got a minute left still in this jam.
Devastator.
Quarantina recycles up to the front.
Devastator back in, but she's already got the star in her hand. Mike sent to the penalty box for out of play, and Jersey puts up another five. 25 points, tying last game's high score.
That's right.
Jersey Justice pops into the pack.
Devastator is out of the pack.
She has decided to put the star back on. Jersey, though, completing another pass, picking up four. 29 points for the Bad Apples.
That was a huge jam for the Bad Apples.
Yes, 29 points pulls the Bad Apples ahead pleasantly to 69 at USPS at 35. 9 minutes left in this first half. I feel like USPS is doing a great job defensively, except in that last power jam against Jersey.
Yeah.
But they've already given up two power jams.
Keeping your jammers out of the box. That's it's weighing the risk of doing something as a jammer that might grab you a penalty or relying a little bit more heavily on your blockers to help you get out, even if you don't get lead. Nady Friday pushing up through the front, though. She does punch out for lead jammer.
Charlotte Bipowski in black and red with one more to beat.
Oh, Love Hurts trying to get her hand, trying to get her hips on her. Bipowski is out. Nady Friday coming back through. She may pick up a back block for that hit, and she does. See, USPS, you know, unfortunately, they've had, I believe, three power jams right now.
Back block being given up. This is the second power jam in a row, and Charlotte Bukowski puts on the speed. 1:24 left in the jam, and we are going the full marathon jam.
Bijou Black and Blue coming through for some nice offensive hits, trying to get her jammer out.
That apple's hanging back, you know, kind of like they fell off the tree. Five more points for Charlotte. She kind of does this tap on her hip.
Uh-huh.
Bijou lays on a block.
Right before she enters the pack, she kind of does a little tap right there on her right leg. Bipowski up at the top against USPS. Friday back in the fray.
Love Hurts recycles her all the way to the back. She Who Hurts, and I believe that's Blue Shell, or no, excuse me. Yeah, that is. That's Blue Shell. Bridging back, taking her back. Nadine Friday gets out. She is eligible to score.
That is a textbook bridge right there. Yep. I think that was the farthest apart that the pack could be and still be
there. Nadine Friday sneaking through on the inside. She picks up 5 points, grand slam.
Again, we are going the full 2 minutes of this jam. Nadine Friday losing lead jammer status when she went out for a back block, but she's certainly making up for it in the points right now, Fiona.
Yeah, right now Bad Apples have a 1 point gain. Oh, but Bipowski does break out. She does pick up another 4 points. Jam is called. Or jam ends, excuse me. You don't see 2 minute jams very often anymore in roller derby.
So score right now 14-9 in that last jam, but keep in mind that Bipowski already had one grand slam before Friday went to the penalty box.
Right.
So only 9 power points in that last jam. So net gain of 5, 84, 48, a palindrome.
Oh, look at that. That's a fancy word.
It is a fancy word. 6 minutes and 40 seconds left on the period clock.
All right, Leslie Borden jamming for USPS. Angela Death coming up in the front for Bad Apple. Oh, Angela is taken to the inside by Barbie Boop, but she does come back in, juke around, and is lead jammer. Leslie Borden still stuck in the back of the pack, being taken to the outside by the Bad Apple blockers. Angela Death, nice hit with by Barbie Boop.
AD running up to the top of the pack with a three brace.
Barbie finishes off. She does go out of bounds, so Angela could technically go in front of her, but that's really risky in that situation as a jammer because you're just not sure there's somebody else that you maybe didn't notice. And you know you could cut when they're right next to each other like that.
Leslie Borden not finishing her initial pass, an additional four points on that pass for Angela Death. We had an update a few years back to the track cut, and I know that it tripped a lot of jammers up for a really long time because what was once a minor penalty became a full penalty, an actual penalty. And so great, actually, awareness on Angela Death's part. Why take the risk of going to the penalty box and giving more points to the other team?
She's a smart jammer. She's been doing this a long time. Phantom Menace playing some defense with her blockers. Jersey gets forced to the inside. Not sure if she can go in or not, but she does take the risk. Forced to the end. Is she getting called for a cut? I believe she is. Well, maybe not.
Lead jammer goes to Phantom Menace. That cut penalty belonging to KO.
There we go.
30 seconds.
Love Hurts headed to the box as well. As is Quarantina. USPS is down to 2 blockers.
Phantom Menace proving her Metachlorian count with that apex jump, garnering 4 points. She calls off the jam. 4-0 in that jam. Score now 52-88 with 4:46 left in the first half.
Bad Apples are starting to pull ahead. You know, when you've got a lead like this, 30-ish points, it's not, by no means a comfortable lead, but, you know, going into the half with a 30-point lead is good. If Apples jammers can stay out of the box, you know, this is where you start to see a team pull away. USPS needs to cut down on those jammer penalties.
Charlotte Bipowski with the star for the Bad Apples. She becomes lead jammer. She's skating against Devastator.
Mike having some good defensive hits from Bad Apples. Oh, takes Devastator with a brutal sternum hit. She may go to the box. That probably was a direction. And she is headed to the box.
Whiskey Ginger, number four, headed to the box as well. 4 points for Bukowski. She calls off the jam. Mike headed to the box. 92-52, 40-point lead right now for the Bad Apples. I am super excited about doing a little interleague playoff between our home teams.
Oh, absolutely. I cannot think of any other state that has the talent that Colorado has with two really high-ranked leagues within, you know, miles of each other. And right now, you know, Rocky Mountain Roller Girls, we are homeless. We lost our warehouse, and Denver has, you know, generously been helping us out and allowing us to rent track time from them. And, you know, we're confident we're going to get it home pretty soon, but it's just wonderful to be able to have two leagues that work together like we do.
It is great, and of course, you know, some people may remember some things in the past that I'm not going to talk about. But
that was a decade ago.
It was a decade ago. It's definitely nice to see, you know, more cooperation. Both teams get better.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, how fun would it be to have a 1-2 championship game at WFTDA championships between Denver and our Rocky Mountain?
Pretty amazing. Angela Death getting through very quickly for Lee Jammer. Nadine Friday stuck in the back. Oh, no, there she goes.
Angela Death with about a half a track lead on Nadine Friday, but USPS lining it up top, those two blockers looking to not be a point. Once Angela Death passes one of them, she picks up all of the points for those who are in the penalty box.
Yep. And USPS is at a disadvantage right now. It looks like Bad Apples has their full contingent of blockers. No, maybe they may have one in the box.
We're down one. Mike is standing in the box.
Mike's standing in the box. So she's coming in less than 10 seconds. USPS, however, only does have two blockers.
KO on the line against Phantom Menace. It was really strange for me at playoffs in Salt Lake. Like, because I'm like, where's Phantom? Where's Phantom? Oh, yes, that's right. She doesn't wear her face makeup at playoffs.
Yeah, not in playoffs.
Phantom Menace out in front. Lee Jammer, KO still in the fray. She does manage to get free, but R2-D2 leading the way as the Bad Apples speed up the pack.
Phantom Menace says, I'm fast too. I'm going to try and pick up my points. She may get one.
Oh, good call. Maybe when you do put your hand up for your jam ref, you do know how many points.
I always feel as a jammer a little bit cocky doing that, but you're like, hey, look, I'm pretty sure I got two.
Well, but I wouldn't turn your hand around with the two, because then you're in Great Britain and that's a bad thing.
Yeah, right?
96-53. We are under the two-minute mark, ladies and gentlemen. We've got the U.S. Pummeling Service versus the Bad Apples here at the Fillmore. We have Charlotte Bukowski on the line for the Apples.
Devastator gets hit to the inside. Nice hit by number 116, Rampage, with the Bad Apples.
Devastator is on the opposite side of the track right now from Bukowski. Bukowski has plenty of time to play with, but she gets knocked to the outfield. Calls off the jam with three
points. Got a nice crowd at the Fillmore. I was these doubleheaders are always a little bit tricky. They start kind of early, but
it is, especially on a Friday night, yeah. You have to fight that Friday night traffic. Shihu putting on the star for the first time in this game. Just know, guys, they are chanting Shihu.
Shihu. She gets lots of love from the crowd.
And against Angela Death, two of the most senior derby players in Denver duking it out right now with stars.
Oh, Love Hurts takes her own jammer to the inside. That is just a horrible feeling. Horrible feeling. You know she'll be apologizing when they come up.
Did you see her hands on her helmet?
She knew was about ready to kill her.
I wouldn't blame
her. It's just
for
one
doing
of those
that.
Heat of the moment. Yeah.
You know, it's a
yeah, cumulative time skating between Shihu and Angela is almost two decades, I'm pretty sure.
And we have a track cut drawn on
and
Shihu.
And now, Shihu is a little bit frustrated. Barbie Boop also headed to the box with USPS. Love Hurts, Nikki Brick saying, we've got to set up a wall. Bad Apple saying, no, we're going to go ahead and keep you guys separated.
See, Mike will lay it down.
Yeah, she's a really hard
Mike
hitter.
Mike is very just no-nonsense. I mean, her name is Mike.
I love that name. I think it's fantastic.
Five more points for Angela Death. 10 in this jam. Bad Apples over the century mark at 109. Angela with one more to contend with and another 5 points.
She who coming back in for USPS, however, she does need to break through this pack with a fantastic apex jump.
Okay, guys, that was 3 feet.
That was amazing.
She got 3 feet of air. That's like a sweet ramp on that side
of
the track.
That was ridiculous. She who's boyfriend Jay is sitting right in front of us, and I really hope he got a picture of that.
One additional 1.4 She who. Brings our score at halftime, 115 to 53, Bad Apples on top. You know, obviously, the story in this game right now is jammer penalties.
Yep, that
every single time there's a jammer penalty. I mean, 1, 2, 3, 4 jammer penalties given up by USPS, 29 points given up in a power jam, 14 points given up in a power jam. 15 points given up in a power jam.
You're talking 60 or 70 points cumulative with power jams, and you can see if you add that together, if they didn't have those, the score would pretty much be tied.
I will make sure during this halftime to add those power points
you do
and
that
see
math.
Whether or not the game is decided by those power points. We are going to take a break. Once again, you're tuning in here on Colorado Sports TV. My name is Miscommunication.
I'm Fiona Gravel.
And we're going to take a little bit of a break. For a drink?
For a drink,
yes.
Yeah, I will never say no to a drink.
All right, thanks. You are watching live roller derby action here on Colorado Sports TV. I'm Miss Communication.
I'm Fiona Grapple. I was going to say, you know, USPS is actually missing one of their power skaters tonight. Triple Shot Misto is not playing. My partner in crime. She had a death in the family. Her grandpa passed away. So she went back home to be with her family, and I'm sure we all miss her, you know, on the track and off.
Misto, I'm so sorry.
I know. Send
I would like
a shout
to say
out.
It gets better, but it gets different.
No,
it
yeah.
It gets different in very beautiful ways, Misto. We're so sorry. So we're going to go ahead and run some statistics from the last half. Presently right now, USPS has 13 penalties. The Bad Apples have 10. Big story, though, comes from the numbers. We had 25 jams in the first half, so we were right. Lots of one pass
jams.
And call off. 11 times of those 25, USPS held the lead jammer status. That does include the times, though, that they lost lead jammer status, which was twice.
Mm-hmm.
And then 13 times the Bad Apples held lead jammer status. High score of the game right now is Jersey with 29 points.
29 points, yeah, that's a huge jam.
And high scoring jammer for USPS is Phantom Menace with only 10.
Okay.
We talked at the beginning about, or right at the end of the half, about math. So let's talk a little bit about math. There are 62 points separating these two teams right now, 115 to 53. Of those 62 points, 53 of them are power points given up while USPS's jammer was cooling her heels in the penalty box. So obviously we are seeing here that the power play is what is coming into play in this game. The one thing that USPS has to do is keep their jammer out of the box.
Yes.
If that means playing a little more conservatively instead of balls to the wall for the jammers, or if that means, you know, blockers kind of watching out for their jammer a little bit more. Something needs to happen quickly for the USPS to come back.
I think it's a combination of both. It's a combination of, you know, if you don't get lead jam, a quick transition to offense, help your jammer out, whether it be a star pass or a really good offensive hit. But you're absolutely right, being conservative as a jammer, and it's hard when you're down like this because you want to get lead. But it does your team, we say this all the time, it does no good. Rather they score 5 points and then you get out, like has been happening when there's not a power jam, then go to the box and they get 25 points.
USPS spreading those 13 penalties thin, most people just sitting on 3 or less. However, Mike sitting on 5 penalties right now for the Bad Apples. We've got Devastator with the star in blue up against Angela Death with the star in black, and she is lead jammer.
Devastator being held by a really strong wall of Bad Apples in the back. She does have her helmet cover off, looking for a star pass.
Angela Death comes into the pack, toes her away.
Looks like that cap has been passed to number 138. Devastator does still have the star in her hand. Angela Death picking up 5 points. Number 4, the pivot, Whiskey Ginger for USPS. Kind of playing a little keep away from Devastator right now. Seems to be everywhere else that she isn't.
Bad Apple's doing a really good job of being aware of that star pass trying to happen, hitting that pivot out while they're also containing the jammer. However, Whiskey Ginger does have the helmet. She's trying to be sneaky. See, she's got it wadded up in her hand there.
Ooh, look at that. That happened on the straightaway.
Yes, that was very tricky. Angela Death coming through to pick up all 4 of her points on the inside, and she does call it off.
14 points for Angela Death in that last jam, 129 to 53 with 28 minutes left in the game. I am seeing something happen with Pivot, taking the star.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you hand off the star, and so you're hoping that the Pivot will be able to score points. In the entire last game, that star pass never netted any points.
Actually, it's really done more to stop the bleeding than to pick up extra points. Typically when a star pass is done, you do not have lead jammer status and you want to just get your jammer out and force that other jammer to call it off before she can make multiple passes.
And Nadine Friday, Phantom Menace. Phantom Menace is lead jammer right now. Charlotte Bukowski about half a track behind her.
Phantom Menace trying to pick up a couple more points. Ooh, she's going to get a backbot call for that hit. Phantom Menace headed to the box. See, this is one of those things where you weigh trying to get a couple of extra points, being a little bit too aggressive versus calling it off and just resetting.
5 points for Charlotte Bapowski.
Trent looks for a spot, toes her away, tries to.
Bapowski fighting way to the front. Quarantina and Shihu trying to hold her back. Flip creating that bridge, trying to give her blockers a little bit of extra time to hold that jammer. They do recycle her all the way to the back.
Finds a little blocking.
Barbie Boop turned around looking for her in the front, taking her all the way back again. USPS doing a good job of trying to kill time on this power jam. Phantom Menace does return from the box.
So we've only got one power, we've only got five power points in that power jam and four put up for Phantom Menace.
Yep.
But we've still got 42 seconds in this jam.
A lot can happen in 42 seconds. Phantom Menace coming through to pick up all five of the points on a Grand Slam after serving her penalty in the box. Bapowski taking a huge hit to the outside. Menace coming through, apex jump on the end, picks up another Grand Slam. Boy, talk about making up for going to the naughty box, right?
Well, that's making up for lost time, very literally. Bapowski with one to beat right now. She is going to finish her scoring pass for 5 points.
Phantom Menace fighting her way through. She's going to try and pick up another 4 points. She does get through with relative ease. Is she going to call it? Oh, no, she can't call it off. There's no lead jammer.
Correct. We've got 1 second left on that jam clock. Bapowski going for something. Nope.
Nope. So Phantom Menace actually picks up a net 8 points.
18 points on that jam. Only 10 for Bapowski. Six of those 10 were power points. She got that fifth point because she scored her jammer lap point while Menace was still in the box. 139-71, 26 minutes left in the game. Bad Apples looking to change it up by putting in 116 Rampage.
Rampage shoots to the outside. We've got Blue Shell coming up the middle. Both jammers still stuck in the pack. Blue Shell punches out in the middle, still in the front, a little bit behind Rampage. USPS holding a good wall in the back, keeping that jammer contained. Somebody's going to the box. Is that Quigley?
It is.
Quigley headed to the box of the blocker. Rampage does punch out in the front. She is lead jammer for the Bad Apple. Blue Shell stuck in the back, coming through for a second approach. She is taken to the outside, but does juke around. Oh, no, she does not. She's going to the box for a cut.
One skate went out of bounds.
One skate. This
off
is one of
turn
those.
Three.
Oh, and Rampage coming through. Maybe she didn't realize that jammer was in the box, but she does pick up 5 points before she calls it off.
Well, Rampage with only a single scoring pass in that jam, probably thinking fresh legs might be a better idea.
Which is completely a very smart thing to do, especially if you're feeling like maybe you need a little rest.
Or if you're feeling like Jersey Justice is the next person in line.
Like, ew, here's a present. I'm going to hand this off to you.
So both teams taking a chance by fielding a new jammer. Not paying off for Blue Shell, unfortunately.
No, unfortunately. Jersey Justice comes through, coming up the middle, strong wall in the front. Barbie Boop. Nikki Bricks trying to take her out, but she does come through. She is lead jammer coming around for her scoring pass.
Quigley ready to rejoin the pack to, of course, to find the pack further back. Right now, Blue Shell on her feet.
Jersey Justice spins around on the inside. She picks up all 5 points.
When a skater is on her feet, that means there's 10 seconds or less left in their penalty.
Bad Apples holding a strong wall in the back, keeping Blue Shell contained.
Got another classic bridge situation happening here, and Jersey says, well, not much troubled water, another 4 points.
Another cut track call for Blue Shell. She was taken to the end. She thought she came back enough, and they jumped back just a few inches and got her on that cut track.
So when you re-enter, is it judged by your skates, your hips? Where do you have to re-enter?
I believe it's hips. I've only been playing derby for 10 years. Don't ask me that question. Hips.
It's always the hips. We don't judge by the skates unless if it's a low block.
I don't know about rules. Come on
I'm
now.
Sorry. I was trying to play dumb so you could sound smart and it totally backfired. That power play, though, did not backfire for the Bad Apples.
12 points. Right, 12 points on the power jam.
Right, 161-71, 23 minutes left in the game, and Angela Death coming out for the power start.
Apples have a pretty comfortable lead at this point. They're up by 90 points. We've almost got 100 on the board above USPS. Angela Death coming through. She's still on that power jam. Blue Shell is still sitting in the box.
Pixie, your battle is being trapped by the Bad Apples defense.
which forces her other three blockers to stay a little bit closer to that pack.
Yeah, Death with a little one-footed skip, 5 points. We've had a lot of skipping and hopping in this game.
A lot of skipping and hopping and jumping and flying. Blue Shell being released from the box. She does need to break through before she can start scoring any points. You know, sometimes at this point it's wise to maybe think about passing that star when you've been to the box a couple of times as a jammer. However, she does a really good job of coming around, but Crash runs to the front. Blue Shell does get around. Her jam is called. 100-point lead for the Bad Apples.
171-71, 22-14 left in the game.
R2-D2 on the line for USPS, who is still the highest scoring jammer for Rocky Mountain Roller Girls against number 82. No, who is that? Bapowski, excuse me.
Yes, Bapowski.
I just saw the
82. We should just say if we don't know who she is that it's Bapowski. Bapowski and kind of a pile-up with Lizzie Borden and Phantom Menace skates free, lead jammer.
I think Menace has gotten lead almost every time she's been out.
In this half, Menace has gotten lead every time, but she did lose lead with that back block, but then, of course, made up for it because that was her 18-point
right.
jam.
Right.
4 points for Phantom Menace as Bapowski breaks free and she calls off the jam. 171-75, 21 minutes remaining. I know that it is cliche to say it's anybody's game. However, Brad Example and I were both there at a home team game when we saw a 100-point deficiency get caught up
yep.
in 12 and a half minutes.
I've seen it happen
more than
once. Yep, it is anybody's game.
Yeah. Well, anybody's not playing, but the Bad Apples and USPS are playing right now at the Fillmore.
Nadine Friday trying to charge through that pack. However, number 80, Angela Death, does break through in the front. Ooh, big hit by Barbie Boot, but she does take herself out. Angela Death is lead jammer. Nadine Friday is being recycled to the back of the pack. Still on her initial pass.
Mike getting at two penalties. That will be seven for her.
I believe Mike is going to be, this is probably it for her. She knows it too. She's taking a knee.
And Smackaroni, of course, headed to the penalty box as well, but this will be Mike's dismissal. We will see an official timeout being called and Hardcore Ken coming in to do some dismissing.
Fouling out is never, and it's happened to all of us at some point. And it seems like sometimes you just have those games where you think that they're picking on me. I know I haven't done that many penalties, but usually the refs are right, even though we give the what-the-heck hands all the time.
Derby girl face is what my friend Samurai Simba calls it. Yes. I would love to say that this is a weird thing for Mike, but
this she fell out a lot.
Mike likes to get the penalties, and they're useful.
She's
they
super
are very,
aggressive.
You know what? Every single one of those penalties is key to gameplay.
Yeah.
It's not like she's just throwing it away on a track cut because she stepped in front of someone.
Well, and you know, it's unfortunate to ever lose a skater on the track, but, I mean, blockers, you've got four of them out there. You only have one jammer. If you got to have somebody go, you know, better it be a blocker to the box or, unfortunately, be ejected than a jammer.
So we have only one blocker out there for the USPS.
Oh,
love hurts. But then we've only
fun.
Got two blockers out there for Bad Apples. We've got Speed of Antees and Quigley. A diet pack, micro pack, little pack?
Mini, a micro pack. That's what Shihu and I were saying last week.
I like Eno Weno pack because it's kind of cute.
So Hertz is going to do the best she can here. This is I've been in this position too. It's a little rough. However, Hertz is a really good positional blocker and actually does a really good job of holding that jammer. She does break through.
That's Rampage,
excuse
your lead jammer.
Lead jammer.
Yeah, see, but you're also dealing against Quigley.
Right, right. Tater does a good job, though, of juking around, and she is out just about a half track behind.
Pack now looking a little fuller for USPS. They're up to three with Rampage rampaging at the top of the pack.
Well, somebody may be going to the box for that. Those pileups are always a little tricky until you see who comes out.
And we have a forearm being picked up by Tater at the end of the jam.
Darn.
Wait. Oh, wait.
I may be. Oh my gosh, is this two blockers and a jammer going to the box here? No.
Love Hurts heads to the box along with Devastator. Okay. We've got a forearm penalty at the end of the jam for her.
And another one of those power jams for USPS. Angela Dead taking the jammer star once again. It's nice to see her jamming a bunch since this is her last time here.
Her last big one at the Fillmore. Yeah. We do have a rescheduled game at the Glitter Dome this Sunday.
Right. You guys got snowed out.
Snowed out a few weeks ago. We will be at the Glitter Dome on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock if you'd like to join us.
Yeah. And I'd like to take a moment to plug my latest reality show. Myself and Homewrecking Havoc from Rocky Mountain Roller Girls are going to be featured on the local Comcast channel starting in April, a documentary called Derby Girls. So I didn't get enough with Amazing Race. I'm doing another
for
one.
For fun.
Is
it like, do you just feel like your life is a little empty if you don't have someone with a camera?
I guess so. You know, I keep telling my kids, you know, I really am a big deal. Like, I know I'm cleaning my own toilets, but I'm a pretty.
Oh, no.
They don't buy it.
So you commented on my broadcast, right? Because there are broads who are broadcasting all night tonight.
Right.
Someone shot me a message. Oh my gosh, are you friends with one of the Derby girls?
For
the
giant
nobody
celebrity.
Nobody cares about the Derby couple that's on. They're like,
she's really cool. And actually, I have a feeling that they're going to go pretty far. There's a roller derby girl on this season of Amazing Race. So, of course, that's who we're rooting for.
They are the truck stop
sweethearts.
Yes.
Yes, I like them. They're very sweet.
And I want to know who the poor person was that picked the shyest member of New Kids on the Block to be on a reality show.
Oh, see, and I said, I wish I could have been on that, though, but I would have been worthless as an Amazing Race contestant because New Kids on the Block was the first concert I ever went to.
Oh.
And if you, I am trying through Facebook, I'm like, I'm going to get to you, Jonathan Knight.
Yeah, I would be a little starstruck. Oh. And I was actually, like, that was kind of the nail in the coffin that my gaydar doesn't work.
Oh.
Because I had a thing for John.
Oh, and he's adorable.
Big
but
thing
yes,
for John.
Yes.
Yes. Well, now it's very obvious.
Yeah,
but, you know.
Oh, he's so sweet.
Like, I get a pass as a fourth grader, but I continued this crush after I learned who gay people were, you know.
Well, that's okay.
That's all right. We got some Head and Shoulders, Knees and Toes, led by Phantom Menace. It's a good way to relieve pressure, I'm assuming.
These long timeouts are brutal. Sometimes they're just long enough that you get a little bit cold.
You stay warm,
yeah.
Stay focused.
We had one in our game, too.
You get to stare at the scary Darth Maul face.
I can always tell when we, like, well, I've never actually played against her, thankfully, when she's had that scary face, but you can tell afterwards who's got her because they've got red paint,
all over.
And she keeps it intact. I said some of us that sweat a lot, like I would just look like I was bleeding from the face down. I don't know how they wear makeup.
Well, that's
like
all right.
That.
That's the Alice Cooper look,
I
my
guess,
friend.
Right? Right? No, that would just be the sweaty
so
Derby girl look.
We are stuck at 1909 with an official review happening. And 1909, that official review is going to be called off, and we are going to be back to the game. 177-76. Angela Death on the line for the Bad Apples. And the Apples thinking that the whistle back.
We're like,
she was like, I want to go, I want to go.
Pavlov's dogs, the minute you hear that whistle, you just jump, you just go.
Just whistle everywhere. But
all
you
right.
Also stop, too.
Right.
I've seen that at RollerCon.
Right.
Oh. Angela Death finds it on the inside. Lead jammer, Bad Apples.
Bijou Black and Blue playing some good offense on the inside, getting her jammer out quickly.
We've got a blocker deficiency, though, for USPS. They are down one blocker.
This is really an unfortunate position to be in when it's a... forcing a power jam, though, on Angela Death. This may buy USPS a little bit of time. Their jammer is going to be released from the box.
And she was already standing, Tater was.
Yeah.
So that means we've got at least 20 seconds on there. And we will go the remaining minute 20 of this jam.
Which seems like an eternity when you're out there.
I like to call them marathon jams.
It is a marathon jam. Mm-hmm. Bijou Black and Blue playing some one-on-one defense. However, Titan is playing some good offense for her jammer. Does get Devastator out. She is eligible to start scoring. Angela Death already standing, though.
Great opening of the back door there by Whiskey Ginger, but hard, Bad Apples defense. I mean, you're going to walk away bruised.
Yeah, that's a good wall.
5 points on the board for Devastator. Angela Death, though, was on a scoring pass when she went to the box.
So we'll see how that fleshes out. Referees do not show the points when someone heads to the penalty box until after their penalty, their next pass, or the end of the jam, whichever comes first.
Right. Devastator swinging around on the outside. She does pick up all five of her points for her Grand Slam. Angela Death being recycled to the outside again. Titan taking her all the way back. She who Whiskey Ginger setting up.
Devastator slamming into KO, D-Day Doll, and Speeda.
Nope. Somebody's going to the box.
And we do have an apple headed to the penalty box. They're down one again.
Angela just took a big fall up at the front. It was either Whiskey Ginger or Shihu. Took her out right at the front of the pack, and then the jam ended naturally.
That jam ended up being net 14-3 in Devastator's favor. 181-89 with the apple still on top. 16 minutes left in the game.
Nadine Friday on the line for USPS against Bukowski. I keep wanting to say Wazowski, like in Monsters, Inc. Mike Wazowski.
Or Bukowski, like the very famous author.
You're smarter than me.
Charles Bukowski, yes.
You with the big words and the famous author.
That's fine, it's fine. It's because it works a lot of ways.
Nadine Friday, lead jammer. Bukowski still stuck in the pack. However, Barbie Boop being sent for a direction call to the box for USPS as a blocker. Nadine coming around, she picked up all 5 points on that pass. Bukowski is out.
But you see the usefulness in that direction of gameplay because Barbie Boop hit her, got the direction, but did not get it called yet, backed it up, put Bukowski way behind, giving a chance to Friday, but she picks up 1 point there with that time that was bought. Score is 181-95, 15:44 remaining in the half. Do you like Colorado Sports TV? I love Colorado Sports TV.
I do too.
Take a moment and click on that donate button. We recommend $5 a game tonight. So if you watch one game tonight, $5. If you watch two games tonight, $10. But we love all of our donors who help us keep this running free for you to watch Colorado Derby.
Phantom Menace playing a little jammer on jammer defense, trying to feed that jammer into her blockers. However, she is now stuck in the back. Bad Apples jammer being recycled all the way back. That is number 4, CMYKO. Phantom Menace breaks through for lead. However, CMYKO is right behind her.
24 seconds for Menace to break the pack. I think that's a record against Menace, maybe.
USPS trying to pick up a couple of points for their jammer before Menace calls it off. Big hit down by, I believe that was
Bijou.
Man, Bijou gets those hips on you, and it is really painful.
Well, I'm pretty sure that back block that she drew earlier on Phantom in the second jam, that was totally her giving up her back.
Yeah.
So the booty is legal, but the back is illegal. And she just had the right angle there that Menace thought she was going to hit the booty, and she hit the back instead.
Got Devastator on the line for USPS, Angela Death for the Bad Apples. She who hit to the inside. Angela Death coming through as lead jammer.
Devastator back in the fray, getting taken out by Quigley.
Over and over.
Talk about a hip 1-2 punch. Right? Quigley and Bijou would be quite a crazy mix. Shihu receiving the star from Devastator.
That was a really, really smart move by Rocky. You know, cut those points down, stop the bleeding, get your jammer out. Quigley is really good at recycling, so I've noticed she'll do that quick pop, and then you'll see the jammer think she's going to get by, and she'll run up and she'll grab her again. She's a really smart blocker.
Angela Death picking up 3 points in that last jam, 184-96, 13 minutes left in the game. Apples up at the top of the pack and a brace being built at the jammer line in anticipation.
USPS setting up a brace. Nadine Friday trying a little bit of defense before she goes through. Bukowski breaks through, though. She is lead jammer before turn two.
Bukowski out and ready to re-enter the pack. USPS, though, stretching it back. Friday.
Friday, you know what? That was kind of unavoidable, and she knew it. She got forced to the inside. physics was not in her favor. That was a track cut on Nadine Friday as a jammer for USPS.
I'm only going to correct you because it was a skating out of bounds
penalty. Oh, gosh, I thought it was a track cut.
Mostly because I like to explain that you can't skate out of bounds to avoid hitting.
Kind of an odd call, though, because she was actually hit pretty hard. So, you know, there's that. As a ref, I guess you have to weigh, is it just the force of the hit taking her out of bounds, or is she actually gaining an advantage by skating out of bounds?
And this is totally something that you can show up at the after party and talk to any ref about.
They love
many hours. But they might buy you a second drink.
That's true, if you can get them talking.
2 points additionally for Bupowski, 12 points total on that jam, 196 to 96. That leads still 100 points with 12 minutes remaining.
Do want to send a shout out to all of our refs, our NSOs, our volunteers. People don't realize how hard the ref crew works. These guys are skating more sometimes than the skaters are. They don't get a break. It's back and forth. It's turn. And in addition to that, you have to watch everything like a hawk. It really is. All of us skaters have had to ref at least once or twice, and it is incredibly difficult.
Phantom Menace on the line for USPS. She's up against Rampage. She was lead jammer.
Rampage taken out all the way into the bumpers. That was by Titan, I believe.
That was some derby in 3D.
Menace takes the start, so she's not eligible for lead. So although Rampage is behind her, she is lead jammer and can call it off to stop Menace from scoring.
196 to 96. 11:15 remaining in the game.
Rocky's got all four of their blockers on the back line with Shihu jamming against Angela Death, two OGs on the jammer line.
Well, you know, when the OGs do battle against each other, you know, it's pretty hectic.
West Side versus West Side.
Wait,
we're both on the same side.
We're all on the same side. Oh, no, we're not. Angela with a little block, but Shihu taking the advantage.
Shihu pops and pins her way through, looks for the front.
Big brace built at the top of the pack by the Bad Apple. Shihu forced to the infield by Bijou.
Angela Death still fighting to get through on the out. Really strong wall by USPS. AH1N1 Quarantina for USPS headed to the block as a blocker. Headed to the box as a blocker. Shihu, who cannot be named, is lead jammer. Angela Death is hot on her heels.
Quarantina sent to the penalty box. Shihu in the fray looking for those Bad Apples. She goes for the outside. Bijou, black and blue. She calls the jam.
Shihu does pick up 3 points on that jam, though. She tried to jump around on the straightaway, which is super, super hard to do. But I've seen her do it more than once. Shihu is a super jukey jammer. Like, she just jumps and around. You'll think you've got her, and you give her a little hole, and she's gone.
Do you think that's maybe, like, old lady protection skills? Like, if you could juke well.
I guess. I don't know. I mean, I hope I'm as good of a skater.
196-99 KO in for the Bad Apples.
Nadine Friday fighting her way against a really strong wall in the back by the Bad Apples. KO. Punching through in the front. She is lead jammer. Rocky is at a deficit with blockers. They do only have two on the track right now. Quarantina getting ready to enter the, ready to leave the box. Enter the bottom, I don't even know. Nadine Friday avoiding a huge hit. Quigley taking her to the inside. Nadine does spin around on the end.
That was great control by her, keeping her skate on the inside of the rope.
Amazing footwork
for USPS.
Nadine Friday gets
KO out and ready to score. This will likely be the last pass.
Oh, refs did not pick up that call off.
But not before Friday picks up points.
Bad Apples being awarded 3 points, as are USPS. That was essentially a zero pass.
8-3 in that last jam. USPS breaking the century mark, 102-204. Bad Apples, 8 minutes and 30 seconds remaining in the game. Again, Rocky Mountain and DRD are both playing our home teams against each other for an intra-league home team championship. Menace up at the front of the pack, just basically one woman steam shoveling.
Just a train right through. Bupowski fights her way through. She does come out right behind Menace. Menace has a chance if her blockers can slow this pack down. She does have a chance to grab a few points. And she gets all four before she calls off the jam. Menace is really good about swinging her hips around at the very last minute. She's good about trying to grab that last one or two points.
Right, that little
as she's calling it off. Yep.
Yep.
204-106. Got Blue Shelley on the line for USPS. This is how many jams is this for her? Three, two, three,
this
four.
This is her fourth jam, but that's because she was kept in two jams in a row by two track cuts. I am not sure I would field her, but you know, that's just me. I haven't coached and I haven't skated, so, you know, take it for what you will. AD up at the top of the pack against lead jammer.
Blue Shell fighting her way through. She is being contained. Almost through and then taken to the outside by, can't tell who that is.
Oh, we have a whiteboard in our way, ladies and gentlemen. Angela Dead with 5 points. Blue Shell looking for it on the infield.
Blue Shell may, you know, this is one of those situations too where you might want to consider passing the star. Where is her pivot? There she is. Barbie Boop is the pivot. So there is Blue Shell does have the helmet cover off now. She is thinking about passing that star. It's hard as a pivot though, because now Barbie's engaged with the jammer in the front, so she really can't help her jammer. Nice hit to the inside by Barbie Boop.
Angela Death taking control though, spinning around to recycle.
Quarantina taking Angela Death to the inside again, almost the exact same place. Tying Quarantina, trying to contain Angela Death. She does swing around on the outside and does get through for another 5 points. Barbie Boop has the star on.
Barbie Booth shoving at the top of the pack against Jersey. Jersey, though, knocking her to the infield.
Angela takes 5 points again.
30 seconds left in this jam. This is a 20-point jam for Angela Death so far.
Angela finds on the outside with a
Barbie Booth still battling against Jersey on the track.
Barbie Booth taking.
It's like Jersey got her number and it's 5-5-5,
right? Oh, Barbie fights her way through. She does finally break the pack, quickly giving the what-the-heck skater arms.
Barbie Boop is out now. Barbie
Angela Death comes through. 30-point jam for Angela Death. 29. Oh, no, you're right. It was only 4 points.
233-106 now. Bad Apples basically sealing the deal with 5 minutes left in the game.
Yeah.
But this is the thing I love about Derby, is that we don't stop when we decided that a deal is sealed.
No.
Because who cares about sealing?
And you will see these teams play as intense if there's a 200-point lead as there is if a 2-point lead.
Devastator on the line against KO.
KO still fighting her way through on the inside. Devastator being hit to the end and recycled back by number 75, Bijou Black and Blue.
But Bijou gets called out on the way.
Bijou is going to the box for one of those hits.
KO with lead. Devastator, though, out. One thing I've noticed about Devastator is that she rarely allows more than one pass to happen.
Yeah, she's actually a really strong jammer. Big hit.
We almost got Derby in 3D.
Flip and Nikki Bricks took each other out on that. Tater, like I said before, she's a fairly new skater. And her and Nadine Friday, both of those girls, have not been skating, you know, all that long in the grand scheme of things. And you know, it's been really fun to watch them just steadily improve and get better, really every month.
And that's really something that I love about Derby as a sport in general. I mean, you can have someone who's an unknown, a not known, and all of a sudden, all it really takes is one off season and them taking it seriously.
They want it bad enough, yep. Phantom Menace trying to fight her way through on the inside. She does come out and is lead jammer for USPS. Lepowski is right behind her. Ooh, taken down, but still in bounds. Quarantina recycling up to the front. Good lateral movement from Tina.
Great bridge building by USPS. They have effectively reabsorbed Lepowski.
Allowing Menace to come all the way through and pick up. Did she get a grand slam? She did. She got all 5 points on that.
5-0 in that jam. 236-112, 3 minutes left in the game. But yeah, I mean, you don't see this in like beer softball or other amateur type things like that, right?
Right.
You don't say to yourself in your beer softball league, man, that dude, he came out of nowhere, and all of a sudden he was playing first base right? like a crazy man. Right? No, but in Derby,
that's a beautiful thing about it. Yeah. And I love, you know, both of these leagues have A, B, and C travel teams, so you've got skaters that are just getting trained up every season to move up. Number four, CMYKO being taken down in the back by USPS. Nadine Friday, lead jammer.
We've got Jersey sent to the penalty box.
And Titan for USPS.
KO out and ready to score, but Friday already in the fray, and she's only got two to beat and picking up extra points right now, I'm sure, for that penalty box.
Picking up extra points and also sending another bad apple to the box, I believe. Maybe not. I thought I saw him signal a penalty.
Leave the penalty being assessed to Pixie. Ah. Number 1968 for USPS.
Oh, Barbie and Shio giving a Barbie look like, oh boy.
Got an official timeout being called. 236, 116, 142 left on the clock.
And Barbie Boop, you know, you watch this girl, and she's just a ridiculous badass on the track. You know, she has three kids. So she's a full-time mama and a Derby girl.
You know, I don't ever feel surprised when someone has multiple kids and is a good blocker.
Right?
I don't ever feel surprised. I don't feel surprised about Misto's many kids. I don't feel surprised about your many kids.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, between me, Misto, and Barbie, we have almost a dozen children. Good Lord. I don't even like kids.
And it makes perfect sense to me because, I mean, you don't want to beat your children, but you certainly want to beat people right? on the track, right?
I have an 18-year-old who's been mortified for 10 years that his mother plays roller derby. I mean, would you want your mom to play roller derby?
Dude, you know what he is? He's like 4 years off of trying out for men's. That's what he is. Mom, I'm on a men's team.
That poor kid. When we did Amazing Race, they did the intro and they had him rake leaves. And he looked like he just wanted to die.
That's good. That's perfect. That gives good face, right? You know?
All right. We've got
Colorado actually home to a men's team, Denver yes. Roller Derby, home of ground control. Dave Wood.
Our Fight Club coach, Dave Wood, one of the skaters with the men's team.
He did recently test up to being full member of our A team.
I just took some pictures of him jamming. All right, Angela Death skating jammer for Bad Apples. However, Devastator punches out. She is lead jammer for USPS. Angela Death getting recycled back to the inside. Barbie Boop taking her all the way back. Barbie Shihu lining up. You know, that was quite the accomplishment. They were at a deficit when that jam started. Devastator calls it off, picks up all four of her points. I know, it's just like what you said, you know, it doesn't matter what the score is. You see these players playing like it's a two-point game.
Was a four-point game, 4-0 in right. USPS's favor. 120-236, a minute on the clock.
Possibly the last jam. We could potentially see two.
Bukowski on the line for the Bad Apples. She is skating against Nadine Friday.
Nadine Friday trying to push her way through on the outside. Bukowski swings in, goes out, being held back by Love Hurts and Quarantina. Oh, Nadine Friday getting sent for a back block. This is probably going to end this game. Nadine is not happy about that call.
I was actually worried about her forearms. Her arms were kind of going a little crazy when she was doing the shove through.
Like you were saying before, you know, as a jammer, when you slam into that wall initially, it is really tricky because if you hit it wrong and you fold somebody in half and they go down, I mean, you're going to the box.
Bukowski in the pack now on her first scoring pass as lead jammer. She's looking at the clock. We've got 5 points for the Apples.
We've got 1:18 left on the jam clock, 8 seconds left in the period. She may just run this period clock down and then call it.
She certainly will because USPS is actually still sitting on one team timeout right now.
They are. Yep.
So which if there is period clock left, they could call timeout.
Get an extra jam. And that is going to be the game. Unofficial score, 241-120, Bad Apples.
9 points for Bukowski in that last jam. If you'll bear with me here, I will do some maths real quickly.
And please feel free to come out to give congratulations to the victorious Bad.
This is my favorite part of roller derby. Whether you win or lose, I love going around the track and all the little kids. that line up and you get to smack their hands. It is so much fun. And the Fillmore is just the coolest venue to play derby in.
It definitely is. USPS lining up to congratulate the Bad Apples on their hard-fought win.
And now everybody's going to go drink beer.
I'm counting, guys. I'm counting, sorry. I rock it analog in my notes, my unofficial stats. Okay, so here at the end of the game, we had 23 jams, and it's really telling. USPS only held lead jammer status 8 times. And now this time, that number does include, like, if someone got lead jammer and lost it, I didn't count it.
Oh.
So that's 8.
Okay.
And then 11 for the Bad Apples. But still, 11 out of 23, that's
right.
Less than half.
Right.
And Angela Death putting up the high score for the Apples, 29 points, 18 for Phantom Menace, continuing her high scoring run. This time, the penalty box did not play so much in the Bad Apples' favor, but I really think, except for those double whammies
at the beginning.
But I really think it was just momentum that the Bad Apples caught in the first half, and they kept carrying it on. So now the Bad Apples versus USPS, Apples come out victorious. We will have further games this year between the Rocky Mountain and Denver Roller Dolls, Denver Roller Derby. Home teams, we will have a championship game that figures it all out at the end based on those records.
And you can find our schedule at www.rockymountainrollergirls.com. That'll show both our games at the Fillmore, the interleague games, the travel team games. And I believe Denver Roller Derby's website is now www.denverrollerderby.com, correct? I'm going to use my powers of deduction.
Okay, we were org. We used to be org.
Were you org? Both of them will probably go.
I apologize, folks. But you can find us on Facebook at Denver Roller Derby.
All right.
That I could do. I apologize. Thank you so much for tuning in to us here on Colorado Sports TV. Once again, my name is Ms. Communication.
I'm Fiona Grapple. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming. I had so much fun. I about fell in love with you last week. No, really. You know those ladies in the African-American church that stand up and they're like, yes, hallelujah. That's how I was during your game last week with
Shihu. Thank you.
Amazing talent on your part, and I look forward to working with you again.
Well, she who makes the easy, as do you. So thank you very, very much.
Well, you know, I'm easy.
Oh, me too.
Oh, so. Look at that.
Yeah,
ladies and gentlemen.
Easy.
All right. Thanks so much, folks. Make sure to click on that donate button on the way out. Have
Give
a good evening.
Give us your money. Have a good evening.
Bye.